geeks and comic book losers and all the smart sorts. This is for the tabletop dice rollers and poetry readers and every nerdy kid who's still repping the art form.
Welcome to A Comic Spot Episode 4. This is a conversational podcast where we discuss everything nerdy from the previous week. I am your host, Antonio, and with me as always is my illustrious co-host, Julian.
That's true. I am illustrious, or whatever that word means. So if you're listening to this podcast, either you're new or, you know, you've managed to stick with us for three episodes now. Either way, thank you for listening. And last week we had our first guest and I think that it went pretty good.
Antonio, yeah, I like the dynamic of having three people on this podcast. Yeah,
three people was it was great. It was definitely look forward to that. Look forward to more guests, and hopefully we'll try to get a third co-host on the podcast soon.
Definitely. I mean, we really want this to be a community, and I guess two people doesn't really scream that, so try to expand.
But basically, it's the beginning. We're still sorting some things out. Hopefully this, hopefully these upcoming episodes will be great.
Yeah, so if you guys are interested in co-hosting a podcast about all things nerdy, send us an audition tape. Doesn't even have to be for our show. It can be for any show that you audition for. Yeah. We'd love to see them. And
so,
share them.
Definitely. So do you want to just jump right into it or what?
Yeah, let's jump right into comic news for the week, or, you know, comic talk.
Yeah, like we always do.
All right, so I'll start things off. Last week, you guys might have seen the second episode of the Comic Drop went up, and it was at least 90% better than the first episode, yeah. I would hope.
As your editor, it was. It was.
Okay.
Yeah. We still got ways to go, but still.
Oh, yeah, definitely. But I'm trying to make that show the best it can be. This week, I will be filming again at Heidi Ho Comics, and for every week in the foreseeable future, I will be there. So if you live in Santa Monica, come by and say hi, talk about comic books, whatever. I'm always open for it. Maybe be on the episode. We'll see. I just wanted to, you know, give that a shout out. Heidi Ho Comics has been really great for letting me film there. Really cool guys. Also, they're co-owned by Jeffrey's Comics now as well. Really great store. So check those guys out.
Yeah. And unfortunately, I wasn't able to post Seeing Spots Episode 2. I noticed that a lot of things happened during the week and it just pushed my schedule forward and I wasn't able to really edit or, you know, record anything. And by the time that all this quote unquote news could have been filmed, it wasn't really news because the next big story happened and I was just falling behind. So hopefully I could get back on that, you know, start recording regularly and uploading even faster to keep up to date with all this crazy news coming out.
Yeah, that's sort of our hopes with just getting things more succinct is, you know, really getting on the news quicker and getting the discussion open a lot faster.
But yeah, like I said, we're still figuring things out as we do it, so who knows. But yeah.
Back to comic time. What have you been reading this week, Julian?
In the last podcast with our illustrious guest Rocco the Great. See, I used
not that illustrious.
I mentioned that I picked up Zero Year by Scott Snyder. Once again, we're talking about Scott Snyder on the podcast. I mentioned that I picked up Zero Year, but that I didn't have time to read it. I actually did manage to read it, and I thought that it was fantastic. I like that. I like that it retold Batman's origin. Well, yeah, okay, yeah. It retold Batman's origin, not okay, Bruce Wayne's origin. You know what I mean?
Let's unpack that for people who don't know what Zero Year is really quick.
Yeah.
So for those fans who haven't read Scott Snyder's run, first of all, pick it up. It's great. You can read it out without any prior Batman knowledge. It's just a really great Batman run. But what he tried to do with Zero Year, Scott Snyder is a self-profound, huge fanboy of Frank Miller.
Oh, yeah.
And we all know Frank Miller wrote this great one series called Batman Year One, which basically depicted the first year of Batman's life on the job. And it wasn't exactly a year, I think, in the comic, but, that was the basis of it. And so Batman Zero Year is sort of the companion piece to that. It does rewrite some of it, but it serves as the new year one.
Yeah, like the new version, the updated version of that, while tweaking some things at the same time, you know?
And paying homage to it in a lot of ways.
Oh, definitely. It was a fantastic read. I really like the Red Hood gang. I like, What else? It was great. It was great. I love Edward Nygma.
Oh yeah, you know, Nygma's great in it. A lot better than he is on Gotham. I'm waiting for Rocco to come like back and kill me now.
Well, Rocco's not here, but I am. Also, fuck you. Gotham's great. We'll talk more about that later, Antonio.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, so just more about Zero Year, though. So you finished Secret City, right? That's the first volume?
Yeah, Secret City, so, and I need to pick up the other two. I'm not sure what
Yeah, there's two other volumes. It was a big event. It spanned, yeah. I think, almost a year, so maybe more.
What are the other two?
I don't remember the names of them, but Volume 1 mainly focuses, I believe, on the Red Hood gang, and I think it introduces you to the other villain, who I don't want to spoil if you haven't gotten there yet, but he's really creepy.
Okay.
And then the third volume I know is mainly centered around the Riddler. So I believe, has the Red Hood story run its course in the first volume?
In the first volume, yes. But what would you, well, spoilers? Should we give spoilers?
Okay, let's just give spoilers really quick. No, fine. We'll let you guys read it for yourself.
It's a great book. No spoilers. Yeah.
The second volume details a villain called Dr. Death. And that's all I'll say about it.
All right. But yeah, I read Zero Year. I thought it was fantastic. You know, I haven't picked up much other things, you know. Yeah, that's it, really. What about you?
Well, I mean, I talked about most of what I read in terms of new comics on the Comic Drop, which, yeah. I mean, I'm really happy that I got that up. But what I've been reading this last week, I've actually gotten really into digital comics, something I never thought I'd like. A lot of people have told me that that's how they read comics now. And as someone who reads new comics every week, I'm not too into it because I like having the paper copy.
Yeah.
Mainly for the sake of I like giving it to friends and, you know, getting them to read it. But this week I downloaded Scribd, which proclaims to be the Netflix of comics. I got a 2-month free trial through IDW. I think that promotion has ended, but if you go through their website, there's still a free month trial.
Okay.
And I read some comics on there, and then I realized it just didn't have the selection I wanted. So it's still a great app, and I still strongly suggest checking it out, especially if you're a new comic fan. Getting a free month is great. You can really get into some stuff you've never read before. But for someone who, you know, is a little bit more learned on Marvel, I bought a month of Marvel Unlimited, which is Marvel's personal digital comics app, and basically gives you unlimited access to their digital comics library for a month.
I jumped from digital to physical copies. I don't know. It's something about having to do more work to actually read the comic book, you know.
I think my issue, not my issue, but the reason I've really liked digital comics this last week is I read them at work. So I've gotten so much reading in on the job, which is probably not great for my employer.
Yeah,
but
you're going to get fired, dude. Why would you say that?
but it's a lot of fun. And so basically over the last week, I have read all of Mark Millar, Jonathan Hickman, and Matt Fraction's run of Fantastic Four. I mean, I've read them before, but it's been a long while. So it was really great to get back to them. It gave me some chills down my spine at some points.
That's good.
They're
though.
Great. Huh?
That's good. That's awesome.
Definitely.
I want to pick that up or not pick that up. I definitely want to check that out, because if I could get an actual subscription and be up to date on all the Marvel news, fuck yeah, I'll do it.
Yeah, definitely. So that's what I've been reading the last week. I've been on a huge Fantastic Four kick.
After that trailer or what?
It was a bit at the trailer, but then the other thing is Secret Wars is coming up this this May. I've talked about Jonathan Hickman every week, so we'll throw him in there as well. And reading his Fantastic Four again, like I told you, I think 2 weeks ago that, you know, he's been setting up to this for as long as I've been reading comics, and to see these little things that are like, wow, like maybe he didn't even know it at that point, but he went back and drew on that. It's been, you know, crazy to just like, especially at the end of the run where he knew it was coming for sure. And he's like giving you these, you're going to do this, you know, moment.
Yeah.
Like when he's showing you Black Panther and Namor and Black Bolt before New Avengers, before where they are then. Like obviously there's still more that happens to them in between that, but he's showing you like when you hear him really quickly, I'm just going to put a little spoiler on, because you've read the first volume of New Avengers.
I have.
There's a moment in the end of his Fantastic Four run where he says the line, everything dies.
Yeah.
And I lose it.
I remember. You always freaked out. You're like, dude, you have to read the New Avengers. Look at this first page. Tell me that doesn't make you want to read it.
So there's a moment in the end of his Fantastic Four run where you see Black Panther getting like this prophecy of the future, and he's told everything dies. And you see Black Bolt getting this prophecy of the future, and he's told everything dies. And you're like, holy shit.
Wow.
Like, obviously, for people who had remembered that or who had read it more freshly in their minds, that was like, oh, here it is. But, like, for someone who had gone, you know, who hadn't remember, you know, who hadn't read that personal issue in, like, 3 years.
Yeah.
That was a big deal for me. So that was...
speaking of Matt Fraction... Let's talk about that charity.
Yeah. Okay. So some of you might know that a little independent film called 50 Shades of Grey released last.
I heard that movie just was terrible. I really did.
What were you expecting? A lot of people have been confirming my beliefs that it's just not well written, really bad film. Sort of followed the suit of the books. Obviously, were very popular, but not exactly for their writing prowess. So the films to just carry on with that.
You mean you don't love the book for its fucking, for its content?
For its characterization thought out drama. Yeah. The main problem with the movie doesn't lie in its writing. It lies in the fact that
it's glorifying, like,
well, let's first say, obviously, there's no problem with S&M or BDSM in a consenting relationship. There's no problem with kinks or anything like that.
No.
There is a problem with using that to excuse abusive relationships.
Exactly.
And so Matt Fraction, fantastic writer. He's the penner for Hawkeye and Sex Criminals, which, by the way, Sex Criminals should be like the modern day 50 Shades of Grey. What I mean by that is it should be the one that's getting a film and being considered widely popular as a sort of risque comedic, look at sex. And so Matt Fraction did this awesome thing with his, I think it's his We Love Fine Shop. Basically, he started a charity called... let me remember the name of the charity really quickly. 50 Shades of Futures Without Violence. And so basically any profits that he made on his We Love Fine store for Hawkeye merchandise, he would match to a donation for this charity to stop domestic abuse. So that's just really cool of him. We need more things like this in the world. It's great to see comic writers step up and take a stand against stuff like that.
Yeah, especially over the like basically glorification of fucking, of like, I don't know what to say that hasn't been said about the 50 Shades of Grey movie and the way that, like, everything is portrayed.
Yeah, and but, I mean, we aren't the topmost experts.
I mean, I could barely read, so I'm just going off
comics.
I'm just going off of what people describe to me about the movie.
But yeah, so I mean, that's just cool of him, especially as someone who writes a comic about, you know, sex largely, to make that clear that it's, you know, it's not the same thing. By the way, pick up Sex Criminals. Great book.
Oh, I still haven't picked that up.
I strongly suggest it. Volume 1 is only $10. You have no excuse.
My excuse is that I don't have $10 right now. So there you go.
All right. So did you have anything else you wanted to talk about, Julian? I have one more thing. And by one more thing, I mean 10, but I'll count it as one.
That's usually how it is. I don't have anything. I don't have any new stuff to talk about. I mean, I could give all my my picks of what I suggest readers or listeners should read, you know.
Oh yeah, if you want to go just run down them really quickly, that's fine.
All right, so clearly Hawkeye, mentioned that before, clearly Daredevil. Now this book, it's old. Well, it's not old. It came out, I think, 2 years, maybe? I don't know. Morbius, the Living Vampire, right? I've tried talking you into reading this.
I read the first issue. I didn't hate it.
You didn't... But you didn't love it?
It just didn't grab me.
Now, I was the same way reading it. I bought it first, and I bought it first because I had a long train ride home. And on the train ride, I'm just like, fuck, did I just make a mistake and buy a boring book? turns out that it wasn't. It was actually pretty good. Like, the more you get into it, the more you realize that Morbius isn't really the smartest character. Like, yeah, he's a scientist and a doctor and whatnot, but... In the end, he's sort of like an average dude who fucks up quite a lot when he tries to do like normal things. He's like...
Well, he did accidentally turn himself into a living vampire.
Exactly. And it plays off of that a lot. And I guess I could compare it to, you know, Hawkeye in Matt Fraction's run.
Mm-hmm.
He's always trying to do the good thing. And well, basically, he sabotages himself and he fucks up. He's like, oh, shit. Right? You know, you understand what I mean?
I understand what you mean.
Morbius is somewhat like that, but either way, it was I really liked it. I really like Morbius, and I suggest that. Another one is Dan Slott's Silver Surfer. I thought that one was
Dan Slott's Silver Surfer is fantastic.
Yeah, I really
like it. There's actually a new issue of it coming out this week.
Oh, I need to pick that up.
Yes, I'll talk about that this week on the Comic Drop.
I like that the Silver Surfer, well, to me, he's more human than humans are, if that makes sense. You know what I mean?
Yeah, definitely, definitely.
Does it? I say that because...
Well, I mean, the story is from him as a tourist, so it's sort of everything else seems more alien when he's your anchor.
Yeah, that's true. But I another part that I really liked in that story is that he has, I guess he sensed, I'm trying to remember off the top of my head, but I think he sensed every like molecule or something, or he experienced every radio wave. And basically, he's seen every movie in existence, listened to every song and all that stuff.
Yeah,
and,
so he instantly knew pop culture.
Yeah, so he's like a pop culture buff, right?
Way I look at it is that Silver Surfer is sort of Marvel's version of Doctor Who in a lot of ways.
Yeah, I know that.
Now, Doctor Who has sort of become something that I'm not a fan of anymore, but Silver Surfer is that idea of a, you know, interdimensional companion, you know, who goes on these amazing adventures, and they're sort of campy, and they're kind of... you know, saving different worlds and stuff, and you get to see these really psychedelic visions of different alien planets, and it's really fun.
Yeah. Now, that's it, really. That's all that I have to suggest. You know, what about, let's get back to what you wanted to talk about.
Okay, so today, Marvel put out their solicitations for the covers for May, and starting this May is Secret Wars #1, their big event for the summer that will supposedly end the Marvel Universe as we know it. And so I just wanted to sort of talk about them really quick because there's a lot of interesting stuff in here, just because moving forward, the Marvel Universe is no longer the 616. You know, it is Secret Wars. This is the new, the new continuity. So let's start off. Obviously, the first things they showed off was Secret Wars #1, which is the collision of, the final incursion of Hickman's run. Basically, the Ultimate Universe collides with the Marvel Universe and Battle World is formed. They also showed off the cover for Secret Wars #2. So we've got two issues in May. I like that they're doubling up, so we don't have to wait an entire issue between the chapters. Then we've got some of the Last Days titles. So for those of you who don't know, there will be three different titles for the Secret Wars tie-ins. There's Last Days, Battle World, and War Zones. And Last Days basically talks about essentially the last days of the characters in their respective books, you know, how they deal with the end of the world.
Yeah.
So there's a few of those, nothing that really, you know, stands out, because they're mainly if you're reading that specific book, you know, why you would be interested in it. But then we move on to Battle World. And one of the ones that stands out to me just off the bat is Inhumans Attilian Rising. So what it looks from the cover, here, I'll read the solicitation just really quickly.
Yeah.
There is a rebellion brewing on Battleworld, and it stretches far and wide into every domain. Medusa, ruler of Attilian, is tasked with uncovering the leader of this uprising and scuttling it with extreme prejudice.
All right.
When she discovers the leader of this rebellion is Black Bolt, however, things get complicated. So basically, the Inhumans make their move, is what I'm getting from this. And that's exciting to me, because Marvel has been pushing the Inhumans these last few years. We know that they're sort of their version of the mutants in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. And because of that, they've been sort of promoting them more heavily. So it's just cool to see where that will lead. Because I think that with the new Marvel Universe being formed, the Inhumans could have a big part in that. The next big thing I want to talk about was Ultimate End. It's the official last run of Ultimates, essentially, and it deals with it's under the Battle World motif, I think, not the Last Days, but because the series is called Ultimate End, we can predict that it's about the end of the Ultimate Universe and how they directly deal with it. So that'll be interesting. It's Brian Michael Bendis, of course, who started with Ultimate Spider-Man, and Mark Bagley, who also started with Ultimate Spider-Man. So it's really like it's the beginning of the end with the end of the beginning.
The beginning of the end with the end of the beginning, huh?
You know, just purposely more confusing than it had to be. There's a bunch of silly books like Master of Kung Fu and Battle World. I mean, that's not silly, but it's cool. Yeah. We've got the MODOK world where everyone's
a MODOK. Yeah, I want to talk about that. Wait, MODOK world or...
Like there's a few MODOK books, but one of them is MODOK world, where it's just everyone's a MODOK.
Oh, I was talking about, what is it? Kill City or Kill World?
Okay, so it's MODOK Assassin set in, I think it's called Kill City or something along those lines. The other big thing, Deadpool's Secret Wars. Now, this one's interesting because it's not set in the new Secret Wars. Basically, this is detailing the original 1980s, I believe, Secret Wars event, where, you know, the original heroes were brought together by the Beyonder and had to fight, and it was a huge toy success. So basically, they're telling us Deadpool was there. No one knew this, and he was doing some secret shit there.
What?
So that's it's taking place in the original Secret Wars, but with modern day Deadpool, or maybe even with that world's Deadpool, but just in the background.
Interesting.
Yeah.
So does that mean that it would be Wade Wilson, or
no?
He's
still Deadpool.
He's
so I don't
still
know.
Deadpool. Okay.
I don't know what it entails, to be honest, but it's interesting to me that
it sounds. It definitely sounds like a trip.
Yeah. The other big things are, so now here's what's interesting to me is that we have a bunch of these series. Last year, Marvel released a ton of teasers during the summer that showed us that next summer we'd revisit a bunch of old famous comic book events.
Yeah.
And we all just sort of started to assume, as Secret Wars became more prevalent, that they would just be parts of Battleworld. Now, they seem to be, but they're not under the Battleworld monikers. So it seems like they are their own series while taking place during Secret Wars. So one of them is Inferno, which is the famous X-Men event with Madeline Pryor. Another one is the Infinity Gauntlet with Thanos, and it looks to be a new version of the Nova Corps. Star-Lord also seems to be in it. But one of the biggest ones to me is the revival of the Old Man Logan universe.
Okay. So do you think that these all take place in their own separate universes that that will collide in Battleworld, or do you think that they take place after?
So see, that's the thing, is that a lot of people, when they first heard these teasers, were thinking, oh, they're going to reboot it and these will be the sort of the new versions of these events, essentially. So like it'll set forth what the new continuity is like. But with Old Man Logan being included, to me it seems like maybe it'll start in those universes and then collide with Battleworld like in the first issue, and then move forward from there. And it's like this is where things happen slightly different. Like they're based on these events, like we'll see Civil War and it's like going normally until it collides with Battleworld, you know?
Okay.
So that's my prediction. Now, here's the thing about Old Man Logan. Brian Michael Bendis is writing it. Andrea Sorrentino is doing the art. I have no problem with Andrea Sorrentino doing the art. He's awesome. Brian Michael Bendis, I have an issue with.
Why? Now why?
Brian Michael Bendis is not a bad writer, but he's not my favorite writer. But the biggest issue is that Old Man Logan was created by Mark Millar, art by Steve McNiven, and it's the most Mark Millar Marvel book we've ever gotten.
Okay.
That's not even necessarily a good thing, but it's authentic in that way. Like it's sort of, if they were going to continue it, it shouldn't be by another writer. It should just be, it's like The Dark Knight Returns being taken up by someone else. And while it doesn't have the same cultural impact or even the same story impact, that's what it feels like to me.
Okay, so you'd rather Brian Michael Bendis,
Mark Millar.
Mark Millar, yeah, sorry about that. You'd rather return.
To be honest, I would rather them just not do a series called Old Man Logan. I'd be fine with the Old Man Logan universe being part of Battleworld if it's written by someone else. This just feels like they're trying to continue Old Man Logan with Brian Michael Bendis. That I'm not a huge fan of. But again, I don't know what this is yet, so we'll see.
So you can't be mad. You can't really.
Yeah,
say
it's just
anything.
I'm confused right now. Let's put it that way. The other big thing is A-Force number one. We talked about that last week. Is getting its first issue. Planet Hulk is returning, this time with Steve Rogers riding Devil Dinosaur, so that'll be interesting. Spider-Verse continues in Secret Wars, which is really interesting because Spider-Verse ended last week, so it's going to be... But with the end of Spider-Verse, all of the Spider-Men were still together, so I'm hoping that means Spider-Gwen, who is on the cover of the first issue of Spider-Verse for Secret Wars, will continue on with the main Marvel Universe.
I mean, I'm pretty sure she will. She gained, like, a huge cult following... I think before
90% was me.
Before she even came out, didn't she? She had a huge following. It was
everybody loved her just from the first image of her.
Yeah, from the costume.
The fact that they called her Spider-Gwen now, because that wasn't even, she was officially Gwen Stacy Spider-Girl, and then the fans started calling her Spider-Gwen, so they titled her series Spider-Gwen. That proves that the following is there. So the thing that you wanted to talk about earlier, I'm getting to now, is MODOK Assassin, which is one of the Battleworld titles.
Wow. I forgot about that. I forgot that I wanted to talk about that.
set in a alternate universe city called Killville is the name. How could we forget that name?
Killville. Now, I think that the cover is a direct reference to Drive with one of my favorite actors, Ryan Gosling. if you didn't know.
Is played by MODOK.
Who's played by what? yeah.
We all know that Ryan Gosling is a mobile organism designed only for killing.
Killing. Now, the cover of MODOK Assassin, MODOK has a toothpick, he's got a hammer, and there's a bunch of muscle cars, and he's wearing like this this nice jacket, right?
Yeah.
It could just be me reaching and tying things together, but it looks like an exact reference and homage to Drive. Mainly because the toothpick and the hammer.
Yeah, definitely. No,
like,
I mean,
those are huge associations with Drive, you know?
I mean, I wouldn't rule that out. Marvel is known for pop culture references.
Oh,
and with this, they have a lot of leniency. I think it screams Drive. I mean, there's no issue with that. It makes sense. It's
an assassin.
MODOK. Yeah. They can base him off anything they want.
But yeah, I mean, that's all I had to say about that, is that it looked a lot like Drive. And I thought that was a pretty cool. I mean, that alone might make me pick up the actual issue.
Yeah, it's very cool. The rest of the solicitations are just, you know, the normal Marvel ones, so I won't go into all of them. I just wanted to really talk about the Secret Wars one, since, you know, this is the Marvel Universe moving forward. So I thought those were cool.
Yeah.
Everything else I'll let the comic drop take care of.
Yeah, you still want to make videos, so.
Exactly.
Talk about everything.
So do you want to segue then into our next?
I think that's it for comic news. I didn't have much else to say. What about you?
That's it for me. On comic stuff.
All right, let's move right into movie news. So, movie news. Jessica Jones is filming right now.
So Jessica Jones is filming right now. We got our first set pictures of her.
Yeah. Nothing crazy. She kind of looks like she has a magenta purplish tint to her hair. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I don't know if you've seen the picture, but
I will say her hair looks a lot darker than I anticipated.
Yeah, but
not really an issue with it.
I think in the light it looks a little bit purple actually, but that could just be me. Nothing crazy.
We're just talking about the shots of her in the parka, right? Like in
like getting out of the taxi.
Yeah
Nothing crazy, you know. It's filming, we don't know much. No sign of the purple man yet, so
well, that's good for her.
Oh god.
Really worried.
Well, judging from Daredevil, I think they might actually go down that route. And I don't want to give away what happens in the original Alias series, but... Mm-hmm.
That's another reason I have an issue with Brian Michael Bendis. It's not a bad series in any sense of the word, but you have to be very careful when dealing with really serious matters. And it did end up feeling a little bit... I don't know. I'm nervous but excited to see what they do with the show.
Hopefully it'll be great. Other than that,
Daredevil looks great, so if that's any precedent.
Exactly.
We talked about that for like half an hour last week, so
So this one's we got some X-Men news. Matthew Vaughn, who directed X-Men First Class, in his original script for Days of Future Past, when he was originally signed on for it, right?
Yeah.
He wanted a new Wolverine.
Yeah, I found that really interesting.
I think that that's great. I think it's about time that Hugh Jackman, you know, gets replaced. No offense.
Hugh Jackman is a great Wolverine, but he was a great Wolverine for Singer's films. And moving forward, I mean, I love Hugh Jackman, but it's time to move on. The same way we moved on from Ian McKellen and Patrick Stewart, etc.
I mean, the torch needs to be passed, and they got new...
Human torch?
Shut your mouth. They got a new, so they got the new original team, you know, Cyclops, Jean Grey, Storm.
So just no Wolverine.
I think it's about time to get a new Wolverine. I don't know who could play him. You know, I think that it'd be nice to get someone short, you know, apart from Hugh Jackman.
If we could just have an X-Men movie without Wolverine again, that would be fantastic.
Yeah, but that's the thing, is that Wolverine is like the draw. Like, Wolverine is what brings in.
See,
people.
But that's just because this is why Marvel to me has become so much more successful.
Yeah.
Is because Iron Man wasn't that draw. Thor was not that draw. Captain America definitely was not that draw.
But
and
at
now
the same,
Guardians
at the same
of the Galaxy.
Time,
yeah,
at the
like,
same time, Marvel didn't have the rights to like Spider-Man, who is one of the most, you know, profitable characters. They didn't have the rights to X-Men or Fantastic
Four. Well, like,
Four.
What I'm saying is that they took that as an opportunity rather than as a...
I understand.
Because,
I understand what you mean.
For comic book fans, obviously, we knew who those characters were, but the public audience, you know, just wasn't... They weren't mainstream.
Yeah.
And it's so great that they are now, just because they are important. And so I'm hoping that moving forward, Singer does that with especially Cyclops and Jean Grey, because even in the original X-Men movies, granted they were, you know, focal points, but everyone took a backseat to Wolverine.
Right. So who do you think off the top of your head would make a good young Wolverine?
Well, off the top of my head, we shouldn't have a young Wolverine. Wolverine should never be young just because he's Wolverine.
Okay, then off the top of your head,
who would make a good new Wolverine?
A good new Wolverine, yeah.
Okay, so it's really tricky because I haven't thought about this. And I do want someone short, but if they can find a good actor who's tall, I won't be mad about it, just because, I mean, Robert Downey Jr. is shorter than half the Avengers. So, like, there's ways to make people look taller than they are.
Yeah.
So if they want to go that route, they can do it with any actor. I'm trying to think off the top of my head who I would choose. There's a guy on Game of Thrones who plays the Hound. I don't know his name, but just visually, if they made him short, he could look like the Wolverine.
If they made him short?
Exactly. If they cut off like 3 inches from him.
Wow.
I really was kind of hoping that when they first announced Peter Dinklage was on Days of Future Past,
you wanted him to be Wolverine.
Honestly, I would love that. I think that he could, like, totally.
Yeah.
Because the thing is that, like, okay, like, people, because whenever I told people this, they asked, well, what about the sex appeal of Wolverine? Well, one, the sex appeal of Wolverine is Hugh Jackman entirely.
Yeah, like, there really wasn't sex appeal to Wolverine.
Like, the whole thing was that, like, why are you finding him sexy just because, he's this hairy beast he's, like, 5'3", you know, he has metal bones and hair that looks like fucking, you know, Gene Simmons on a human day. God damn it.
Al Simmons, isn't that fucking Spawn?
Either one, to be honest.
Either way, we need a short Wolverine.
And so, okay, but then the other thing is that Game of Thrones has proven to us that Peter Dinklage has a sex appeal. So if they want that, it's there.
Look, if you're attracted to Peter Dinklage,
The more important thing is Peter Dinklage is a damn good actor.
He is.
And, like, I mean, so his height would just be a bonus, you know, like, just, he could play, I think he could pull it off. Because the thing is, even with his most, like, knowledgeable characters, the characters who seem the most un-Wolverine-like, you can see him having that drunken old soldier, wiser than his age, you know, kind of feel.
Now, I do agree, but I think that...
Ryan Gosling.
I don't know. I feel like there's another choice that maybe...
Oh, yeah. There's probably, like, a million choices that would be good. Do you have anyone personally that you would pick?
No, because I haven't actually thought about that. The only real actor that comes to mind when I think of, short dude, is Charlie Day from It's Always Sunny.
Who would not be a good Wolverine?
Well, I'm trying to justify why he would be a good Wolverine, but I can't come up with any ideas. So I won't say anything. I think I'm just imagining him saying bub. I don't know.
Well, I'm the best there is at what I do, but what I do isn't very nice. That would be Charlie Day.
But I got a list of other characters that Charlie Day could play, and I'll get into that a little bit later.
Charlie Day would be a great Deadpool.
He would be a fantastic Deadpool, and I think his height would factor into it and make it even funnier. Like, that
yeah,
could be a
especially to be honest, if Hugh Jackman was still Wolverine, like, I would want him to keep being Wolverine just to have the height difference with Charlie Day as Deadpool.
I was also thinking Charlie Day or Rob McElhenney as. Rob McElhenney plays Mac.
Okay.
It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia. Either or. I mean, even both of them as a dual role as Deadpool.
Well, see, that would be fantastic in the sense of I would have Charlie Day play physically Wade Wilson in the costume, but then Rob is his name?
Yeah.
Play the, you know how Deadpool has like three inner voices?
Yeah.
I would literally just have the other two guys from It's Sunny be the other two voices.
See, that would be Danny DeVito and Glenn Howerton. That would be fantastic. Wow.
I will say Ryan Reynolds, fantastic Deadpool from the test footage we've seen. Oh, that's something we need to talk about.
What? Oh, yeah. I've
okay,
got that.
Okay. Sorry. Let's get back to this.
I'll segue into else. You know,
okay.
Don't worry. But yeah, new Wolverine. I don't really have anyone in mind.
And we know it's not happening now that
maybe it'll happen in the future. I mean,
I will say, I didn't expect Bryan Singer sometime to cast new Cyclops and Jean Grey and such, so...
I did, maybe, actually.
Yeah.
Now, there is a piece of concept art. I sent you the photo, actually.
Really quickly, though, can I just... Before we move on from casting an old cast of X-Men and such, I don't think we talked about this last week, but recently Patrick Stewart had an interview, and he talked about the future of him as Professor X.
Actually, that was meant to go on Seeing Spots, which I did mention that I was not able to record.
Would you mind if we just touched on that quick? Because there was two big interesting nuggets there of information.
Patrick Stewart let two pieces of info slip. One, that Magneto will be returning in X-Men Apocalypse.
Which is huge on its own.
Yeah, not just
because
Magneto.
Because what the hell does that mean?
Not just Magneto, but Ian McKellen.
Yeah, he as Magneto.
But I don't think... I don't think Patrick Stewart is returning.
Yeah, so he said that he didn't see himself returning for that movie. Like,
so
no one.
I don't know what that means. Yeah, no one really knows what that means.
Is it time travel? Is Ian McKellen taking Michael Fassbender's place for some reason? Yeah. Is it? Yeah.
And the Wolverine 2 will primarily focus on Patrick Stewart, well, Professor Xavier and Wolverine's relationship.
So it's like a buddy movie between the two of them.
Basically, like they're First sharing all, a movie. With that, that's really awesome. Interesting. Yeah, that sounds awesome.
I want a movie of a... Okay, like, again, I don't think Wolverine should be young, but when I say young, I mean prior Wolverine.
Yeah.
I want a movie about a Professor X who can walk with Wolverine, having that dynamic, especially Patrick Stewart's Professor X, so that it's like they are on par with each other, they respect each other.
Wow. Something
now,
that...
obviously, the continuity is so messed up that whatever they choose will still be way out there.
The continuity is cleaned up. It's like
sure,
clean
it
as
is.
A whistle. No, now it is. It is
okay,
now.
Okay, but like moving forward, what would that mean with Ian McKellen?
No, okay, so I just had this thought and
So what do you think that means, Ian McKellen being in?
Well, Ian McKellen, I don't know. That's, you know, I'm not going to say I don't care, but that's who knows what that means. Hopefully he's not the villain again. I'm tired of seeing Magneto as a villain.
Well, yeah, Apocalypse is the villain.
Yeah, exactly. So I don't know if, like, I don't want Magneto to be in there and have, like, ulterior motives and use Apocalypse against, mm-hmm. You know what I mean.
Yeah.
What I am...
To me, what it sounds like is that it will still be not a time travel element,
yeah,
but maybe parallel timelines where we see what's happening in the future as we see what's happening in the past.
Now, what barely came to mind right now is, so Patrick Stewart said that basically it'll be like a duo. Like, well, it'll center on both of their relationships, right?
Professor X and Wolverine.
It barely came to me. At the end of Days of Future Past, Professor X tells Wolverine, oh, I need to fill you in on all that's happened, right? So I'm thinking that the Wolverine 2 will
you
be...
You mean 3.
Well, yeah.
Okay, the Wolverine
title,
two.
Yeah, the
third
Wolverine
two, film.
The third Wolverine film. I think that will focus on Professor X explaining and, like, basically...
Oh, God, that'd be so cool.
I think that's... I barely thought of that right now, and I really think that's what it's
like,
going to be about.
Even with their weird continuity, I would love that. Like, just...
See,
that'd be cool.
There's no weird continuity anymore. It's cleaned up, man.
It's still weird, even if it's clean.
I think
it's
you weird. Want it to be weird.
I want it to be weird. I want that freaky X-Men continuity.
No, but yeah, other than
we don't know if Jean Grey is dead or not.
The Magneto thing, I don't care. Like, yeah, Ian McKellen's a great Magneto. Other than that, I don't, you know.
See, to me, now that what I'm thinking, if what you said is true about the Professor X Wolverine movie,
yeah.
Maybe Ian McKellen is in, like, a cameo at the end that sort of leads into that.
I can picture
like,
that, yeah.
See, like, what if this, all of this movie is the first story that Professor X is telling Wolverine?
Oh, wow, that'd be fantastic.
Because
like,
I remember
when you've been through all this stuff and all this has happened and you fought Apocalypse, and he's just like, oh, shit, did I?
Well, like, maybe not even that Wolverine fought Apocalypse, but like, just that here's the first part of what you missed, that of things that have changed. Right okay. After this, we now had to deal with a new threat that wasn't there before, something along those lines.
Yeah. Now, speaking of Apocalypse and the character himself, there's a new piece of concept art that Bryan Singer has shown, right? Mm-hmm. And I have my own theories about it. I guess we could assume that it's En-Sabah Nur, which is
okay,
Apocalypse,
so that's what people have been assuming, but
yeah.
we don't have any sort of confirmation.
No confirmation, but it looks like a character being visited by alien technology, right?
Or interacting with what looks to be a ship of some sort.
Now, This is what I'm thinking. This is instantly what I saw, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, the X-Men, as you know, are somewhat a little more cosmic than people realize.
Especially right? in the comics.
Especially in the comics. Now, Apocalypse gained most of his technology from alien ships, if I'm correct. Am I correct?
You're okay. There's so let me clarify that really quick.
Yeah.
So it's not alien technology per se. Yeah. But in the comics, the way Apocalypse gained his technology and power was Immortus, who you might better know as Kang,
yeah,
visited him in the past. And so there's a huge tie-in with Kang and Apocalypse and how Apocalypse came to be. I don't remember all the details, but basically Apocalypse gained his technology from Kang. Now, okay. Obviously, Kang is not owned by Fox, but yeah. So aliens would be a appropriate, you know, sort of substitution.
Now, okay, so like I said, cosmic characters, right?
Yeah, I mean, obviously, maybe, Phoenix is a huge cosmic thing.
Maybe the maybe Apocalypse was visited by, you know...
maybe the Shi'ar.
Extraterrestrial, yeah. Here's what I'm thinking. I've got two ways that this could go.
Thought nuggets.
One is that in the comic books, Apocalypse was known as the first mutant, right?
Yeah.
The X gene originates from alien technology, right?
Interesting.
That's one theory, and that everyone, you know, all the X genes are just basically experiments and all that stuff from alien technology.
So basically, inhumans.
Basically, like they're turning, Marvel is turning inhumans into Marvel is turning mutants into inhumans, and maybe Fox is turning inhumans into mutants. No, mm-hmm. But yeah, you know what I mean.
Yeah, I understand.
But at the same, the other way that I'm thinking about this, and it's mainly because of the design of the ship and how crazy it looks. I may be reaching on this one. Fox owns X-Men,
and they own
the Fantastic Four.
Uh huh.
Now the ship is kinda purple. Looks.
Yep.
It's purple and it's got a lot of ridges and angles and all that stuff.
I see what you're going for here.
It really looks like maybe a part fuck you. It looks like a part of Galactus almost.
Yeah, it does look like
it
a part
really
of
Galactus. It really looks Galactus-y, and maybe if they could also tie in the other theory that I had with the X gene and somewhat tie it all back together with the other existing franchise, I think that it'll be pretty amazing, you know. But yeah, that's basically what I get from it. What about you?
Okay, so obviously we don't know what it is just yet. Like no. It could be anything. This might not even be Apocalypse there. Like this could be entirely something else, just because, you know, we don't know enough about the film yet. So assuming it is Apocalypse, looking at the ship, to me it screams it's modern day. This isn't like some origin. It could be like there's a lot of precedent for it. But to me, it screams, maybe this is Apocalypse's ship as we see it in the 21st century. And to me, maybe that is an Apocalypse, because the color scheme, while it does have that Egyptian armor feel, it kind of also makes me think of a yellow and black X-Men uniform.
Yes. Now.
And because the concept art's so foggy, it could just be that the stylizing makes it look more armored.
Now, I was thinking about this, like, observing the character right now. Does it or does it not look almost like, I think his name is Warlock?
Actually, it does look a lot like Warlock based on the silhouette. It looks a lot like
Warlock, yeah. The silhouette, the colors, the yellow pattern.
Though that might just be coincidental.
Yeah, it might, but either way, that's...
It does remind me of Warlock, and Warlock is from a race of technopathic species that are, you know, robots, essentially. So the spaceship being crazy technology could feed into that.
Hey, so maybe we're onto something here.
Yeah, or maybe we're just fucking crazy.
I guess that's really it for X-Men news. Well, not... Okay, yeah, this is tangentially. Deadpool,
okay,
Deadpool
so...
Deadpool has a casting call, and it started production and all that good business.
Yeah, they did cast... I'm sure I remember the actress's name, but they cast her...
Gina Carino, I think?
Yeah, they cast her as Angel Dust, who is a character I know nothing about, I will admit that.
Neither do I. And I think they're looking at a Morena Bakarin, She's in Gotham. She plays Dr. Leslie Tompkins,
who I actually like.
I really like her character.
They also
Think that she's, well, rumors are that she might be playing Domino, right? I don't know how I feel about that, mainly because I don't really know much about Domino or her character.
I like Domino. I actually really like Domino as a character.
Hey, well, Domino as a character. You like Morena, so I mean,
I actually think that she'd be perfect for it. Now that I think about it, like, she has the cheekbones for it. She has the acting for it. Like, I could see it.
Awesome.
If they wanted to go that route. But the one that interested me was there's been a lot of rumors that Colossus would be in the film, and so I was getting really excited. But then the actor who played Colossus in the last few films, he didn't drop out. Or did he drop out?
Yeah, he's not.
Okay. I know that he tweeted that he's not in it, but I don't know if that meant that he was ever attached to it or not.
It's going to be, they're going to have to recast.
They will have Colossus.
Yeah, they're going to have Colossus. I remember the original script, they had Colossus and...
I am the biggest fan of,
they
like...
They had him be really violent. They had a scene with Colossus that was extremely violent, and I'm still wondering if they're gonna continue with that.
I would love to have Pyotr Rasputin be Pyotr Rasputin and not Peter.
Peter Raz.
Whatever his last... I don't even think they ever say his last name in the films.
No, I think it's just Peter.
Ryan Reynolds has said that their lack of budget means that they want to get the R rating.
More creative. Well, yeah. That means that they have, like, more creativity because they have to work around it. And I think that's a really good way to look at it. They also... there's so many websites I read that where it's confirmed that TJ Miller is in the film.
I'm pretty sure it was confirmed.
I hope he's in the film because he's freaking hilarious, man. I love
TJ. Is he the guy who was in the new Transformers?
Yeah, he was the guy.
He wasn't great in that.
He wasn't great in that. But it's also Transformers, so what do you expect?
I mean, Mark Wahlberg did a Bud Light commercial in that movie, so.
God, that was god awful. TJ Miller is hilarious, and either they're saying that he's gonna be playing he's gonna be playing either Weasel, right?
Mm-hmm.
Who's basically known as Deadpool's sidekick, or he might be a voice in Deadpool's head, like a comedic voice, which I think both are fucking awesome.
I want him to play Bob, agent of X, since we can't have Hydra.
I was thinking of that too, but what could he be replaced with? I mean,
The thing is that Hydra was never really the important thing. As long as he, as long as he's some, you know, they could even just introduce an agency in this and it would be fine. Because Deadpool, a lot of this is going to be introduced for the first time. You know, like even Deadpool himself is going to be reintroduced. So,
but that's it.
The last thing was Ryan Reynolds posted a picture on his Instagram showing us a prototype of the Deadpool mask.
I don't know if it's a prototype. It looks like...
He tweeted a hashtag prototype with it, so I'm assuming that it's not finished.
I don't know. No, but
be vindicative of what it looks like.
Yeah, it looks good, though. Even if it's a prototype, it looks awesome.
Yeah, I mean, it looks like what the VFX test Deadpool looked like.
Yeah.
So that's good.
Let's see, and that's not much else for Daredevil. It's cool to know that it started production though. It's awesome. 10 years in the waiting and fucking.
Yeah. For Deadpool.
Yeah.
You said Daredevil.
No, I did not say Daredevil.
You said Daredevil.
No. No. Well. I guess you know it's
two guys in red tights.
Yeah, two guys in red tights. Doesn't matter. Deadpool, 10 years, and it's finally starting, so it's awesome to see that. It really is. I'm really looking forward to it, and it comes out in a year. Like, I think exactly, well, not exactly a year. It comes out next year.
Sooner than it has ever been.
It's actually happening. That's a trip. It's actually happening. Now we talked enough about, no. I forgot to mention, this isn't like super crazy, intense, you know, anything really. The new Fantastic Four trailer, there's going to be an alternate trailer released with the Kingsman, the Secret Service, right? But it's not going to be anything crazy. It's just going to have like two extra seconds of the Human Torch doing something or Mr. I don't know.
I'm assuming that that's already been released now since on our date, Kingsman came out on Friday. Last Friday.
Oh, well, yeah, it probably, I don't know. I don't know. It's
so the fact that we haven't heard anything about it by now assumes
is,
that there's
enough,
not,
yeah.
Yeah, there's not much new in it.
Yeah, it's nothing, I just want to get that out there for
any DC film news?
Yes. Apparently, it hasn't been confirmed, but Joel Kinnaman, who played the new RoboCop, I know that a lot of people didn't like that film, but, you know.
Really?
Yeah, but his performance was good.
I liked it.
He's a really good actor. Mm-hmm. He might play Rick Flagg, and I'm fine with that. I could totally see it. You know,
At this point, let's just get someone to play Rick Flagg.
Exactly. Anyone's better than nothing, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
They got a good actor. If it's him, then they're good. They're good.
Mm-hmm.
That's it. That's it for DC. You know, nothing really crazy. Oh, damn. I still have all this news that I also forgot to mention on Seeing Spots episode 2 that didn't go up.
Okay, do you want to go over it?
Yeah, yeah. Margot Robbie and Will Smith have started training since December.
For Suicide Squad?
Yeah, since December that they've been, you know, dieting and exercising, all that stuff. You know, nothing out of the ordinary. They're all doing that. And that's it. But moving back to movie, well, it's not TV news, but it's WB, DC, all that stuff. So last week we talked about how John Diggle might be John Stewart
in Arrow.
That was shot down this week. It was shot down.
Why?
It also brought up another interesting piece of news.
Mm-hmm.
They said that Diggle isn't going to be Green Lantern John Stewart because WB has plans for him.
Yeah. See, I'd be excited, but WB having plans for someone doesn't mean a lot right now.
Well, he could appear in Justice League, you know what I mean?
Okay, so like in Dawn of Justice, maybe we get the John Stewart cameo?
Yeah.
To be honest, he's one of the characters who would make the most sense considering he was a military sniper before he became the Green Lantern.
Yeah.
So it wouldn't be too out there to see him, but I was super into the idea of Diggle as Green Lantern. I didn't expect it to happen.
I was.
But it just would have been really cool.
It would have been great. It really would have. He's definitely got that, like, character nailed down. Yeah, it would have been good. It would have been good. It sucks that
now,
they
having
had to
shoot said that, I still think Hal Jordan will appear on Arrow or in the Flash Arrow universe.
Well, Hal Jordan.
Hal Jordan is the Green Lantern. And the reason I say that is two reasons, to be honest. One, if they have plans for Jon Stewart, my bet is that they won't be using Hal Jordan in the films, largely because of Ryan Reynolds' film. But we won't talk about that. But that leads us to the door of having Hal Jordan on the shows. And further in that vein, Hal Jordan and Green Arrow and Barry Allen are known as being like huge friends. Like there was a series called Green Lantern and Arrow.
Brave and the Bold. No, not the Brave and the Bold. I forgot what it was called. But yeah, they're known for being huge, like super close and all that stuff.
And we know that Coast City exists in that universe. We know Ferris Aircraft exists in that universe.
Yeah.
So it's not too much of a stretch. I remember a while back there was a rumor that there was going to be a Flash Green Arrow thing, and everybody was speculating that it was in the movie universe. And I remember I thought that would be a TV special, and it would be the Flash meeting Green Arrow. I think that was shot down, but I would still love for that to be true.
The Flash meeting Green Arrow?
Yeah, sorry, Green Lantern.
Green Lantern. See, I say Daredevil instead of Deadpool. You say Green Arrow instead of Green Lantern. We all make mistakes. But moving on to our last, I know I should have brought this up when we were still talking about Marvel news, but this is our last little piece. It's not confirmed.
And it's not even really speculated.
It's got a really weird source. There's a Lego Ant-Man set, right?
Okay, so first of all, let's just mention that Toy Fair was this last weekend.
Yeah, Toy Fair came out.
For those of you who are nerdy as us, this is a giant press event, or not even press event, but marketing event.
It's like Comic-Con, just with toys.
Essentially,
just with toys, and they're all like pitched to other people. Yeah, that's it. Lego showed an Ant-Man set, and it came with Scott Lang in his normal, you know, normal suit, came with Yellow Jacket, and then it came with Hank Pym in what looks like a darker black version of Scott Lang's suit.
Yeah.
Now that's letting people to believe that Hank Pym might be the true villain in Ant-Man. And I know you, Antonio, I know that you
had a theory about this before.
You've had that theory.
But my theory was a bit different. So really quickly, my theory was that Hank Pym, like in the comics, would be mentally unstable due to the overuse of Pym particles. And we do know that Pym particles, at least the ones that Yellow Jacket are using, have some mental instability issues. So I don't know if that reigns true for Pym's, you know, specific ones, or if that's just for the new, you know, sort of off-brand ones. But my thinking is that overuse of Pym particles left his brain kind of fried, which led to his wife leaving him, which is why his daughter is estranged from him and takes her mom's last name. And to me, that means that Hank wants to get back as being a hero. So that's why he, you know, enlists Scott, but he's formed this sort of, you know, bipolar split personality that is doing the opposite, because to have a hero, you need a villain. And so to me, that means that he's helping Darren Cross build the Yellow Jacket armor, like in the comics where he became the Yellow Jacket himself out of a split personality. He wasn't even aware that he was Yellow Jacket. So there's, you know, obviously there's comic book precedent for this. All of this is just speculation.
Because, our source is a toy.
And is a toy that is known for having some inaccuracies to the film, because, to be honest, that's not their job.
you don't remember when Iron Man fought the Mandarin?
Yeah,
when the Mandarin was in his tank. You don't remember?
And
that?
I love that though, because again, it made people not expect the movie. And I love the twist in the movie. I've gone down and said I love the Marvel Cinematic Universe version of Mandarin.
Now, I don't know how I feel about that. I think it'll be that you think that he might go down the villain route, right?
Okay. Well, okay, but based on this has, to me, the Lego set doesn't say that.
That's exactly so let me get back to what I was gonna say. It was I don't automatically think the villain route. I think that Hank Pym's got this other older suit that he's shown wearing in the Lego set is an older suit, and as one last hurrah to be the hero that he wanted to be, right?
Yeah,
puts it on and helped Scott Lang kick ass, you know, as the two Ant-Men. And
maybe dies trying.
Yeah, and maybe dies trying, you know. But that's what I think. I don't necessarily think that he's going to be a villain. But at the same time, you wouldn't want to get, what's the actor's name?
Michael Douglas?
Yeah, you wouldn't want to get Michael Douglas and just kill him off.
But well, I mean, they did get Michael Douglas and then make him a retired superhero. So
I think, either way, how I feel about that. And everyone's calling him the Black Ant, right?
Okay, so that to me is just grabbing.
Yeah, that's just grabbing. No, but only because the suit that is shown in the Lego
is
set,
darker
it's
than
black.
Yeah.
Basically just black and red. So fans are just calling it Black Ant. So it's nice.
Okay, so to me, what that means is that, like you said, it's an older Ant-Man suit. It's worn down. It's dusty. It's whatever. Like maybe the paint's chipped off or something.
Yeah.
But the Black Ant is an entirely different case.
Oh, yeah. What is it? It's
Eric O'Grady.
Grady's life model decoy.
Yeah, that went crazy.
Rogue. Yeah.
And decided
that's a
to
whole
like
other, that's
yeah
a whole
now
other.
Obviously they can take names from things without using the entire story, but it just
they did that with Anton Vanko and Whiplash.
Yeah
they did that. Marvel has a habit of doing that with
in their defense, they didn't make Ivan Vanko Whiplash, they made his son Whiplash.
Yeah,
so there's still a chance that they could have Ivan Vanko, who is dead mind you, appear in a flashback, because he did appear in the Agent Carter show. Ivan Vanko, for those of you who don't know, is Crimson Dynamo in the comics.
Yeah, Iron Man villain.
Yeah, but he's not the only one, so we can always see Crimson Dynamo as a different person. So but let's get back to Ant-Man.
No, I think that we're done with Ant-Man.
Oh, yeah, well, there you go.
I think that we're good. And now I think I got a lot to say about this
upcoming
TV
news is next.
News. Yeah.
Yeah.
Let's get right into TV news. Now, the first thing I want to say is fuck you, Antonio. I know that you liked last night's episode of Gotham because you fucking told me.
Liked is a very strong word.
You liked it. You fucking liked it. And oh my god, after all these months of it's a bad show, Wow, this is a really good episode. Let's talk about Gotham's. Well, the last episode of Gotham. Let's talk about first.
Okay,
let me
so,
hear what
so
you have
I'm gonna to say. I'm gonna say this first of all. I will admit I enjoyed this episode more than any prior episode combined of Gotham. So
that's
I will
right.
I will give you that. So I'm gonna be totally upfront about that. I'm not gonna act like a little shit about it. So moving forward.
Yeah.
I also have not seen any episode for like 7 weeks or something, so I had no idea what was going on going into it.
Now, like I said, the second half of the season is better than the first half by far.
Mm-hmm.
By far.
And I will say, I still have some issues with it, but I'll talk about those later because they're lesser. But okay, so really quick, the episode is called... The Blind Fortune Teller, which is a little weird of a title since he's not featured in... like 90% of the episode.
That's fine. He was definitely an important character in the episode.
Yeah. Okay, so the episode details Gordon and his new girlfriend, Leslie Thompkin, who you might know from the comics as Bruce Wayne's doctor, go on a date to the circus where they meet the Flying Graysons.
Yes, and while they're at the circus, they find a dead body, right?
Yes, of a dead snake charmer.
Of a dead snake charmer, and they have to find out who killed the snake charmer. And should we get... No, let's not get into spoilers. Let's not. But...
Well, okay, but I think it's fair to say, because every advertisement for the trailer said this.
Yes.
That,
the Joker... So, the well...
A Joker or a
Joker, a pre-Joker or a pre-pre-Joker Joker.
Or a red herring Joker.
Or
some...
a red herring Joker, because he did have red hair. Yeah.
Ha ha ha.
I tied that back in. No.
Do you feel good about yourself?
I do. It's a character named Jerome, right? Mm-hmm. That's all that's known. He's definitely got like the...
Jerome? Starts with a J?
Jerome.
Aren't they clever?
Jerome-ker? You know, starts with the J, ends with the yeah. I mean, if this guy was a Joker, I'd be happy with it. But, how do I say it? Okay, so the character Jerome is definitely crazy. He had the manic laugh. He had the crazy personality. All that stuff. Everything that could be, like, before the Joker falls into the vat of chemicals. Like this guy would be it. Now.
That's sort of the problem for me.
No, all that I want to know. Now, how do I say this? All that I want from this character is that what we've seen, aka him being in the circus, is all we know.
Yeah.
Because the Joker is supposed to be enigmatic and no one really knows his past.
Yeah.
Except for Scott Snyder and presumably Batman, you know, at the end at the end of Death in the Family. But that's all I want to know. Like, I don't want too much information on his past. Like, maybe, yes, have him be introduced in this episode.
Yeah.
And then maybe in, like, if they make it to season 3, have him show up again and be like, oh, he went missing from this amount of time and no one knows what he was doing.
So let me just speak to Jerome really quick.
He's not here.
I'm the Joker. So let me speak to the character of Jerome and what I thought about
more
him.
Like it, yeah.
So first of all, there's good and bad things. One, his performance at the end was fantastic.
Yeah.
The problem, it came out of nowhere in a sense that didn't feel set up. Now, it didn't feel like he was the character who would snap to this point. He obviously was repressed, but it seemed like a very specific, like
a spontaneous, like, whoa, now I'm here.
And now he's an entirely different character who has an entirely different sense of, you know, the world. It didn't feel like this character prior had snapped. It felt like this other character who we should have seen on, you know, sort of the under the surface the entire time showed itself. Like, it felt like it didn't have that setup.
I understand what you mean.
The second thing is, I think this would work better if it is indeed a red herring, but for two reasons. One, it would be clever if they hadn't proposed to us that this is, you know, the Joker, because obviously every teaser for this episode shoved it down our throat that it was, you know, a Joker sort of reference. Yeah.
Not entirely, you know.
Yeah. And the showrunners, I do believe, mentioned that they will be showing us some fake Jokers in this show.
Yeah, they said that, but I haven't seen any. I think what they really said was that in each episode there's a character who's potentially the Joker, right?
So the first episode is obviously that comedian at Fish Mooney's
Well,
Club.
yeah. So, I mean, what the fuck? I think that they haven't really been doing that. Like, they
Or they've
forgot
been doing
about
it in a
it.
way that's just really under the radar.
Yeah, that's true.
See, what I would love for that to be true is if the entire time there's like one character in the background who's doing stuff, like doing things deliberately that are just not menacing. They're just weird. Like they're just like he's like putting a banana in like
A
a
tailpipe.
desk or something.
Yeah.
Like some weird thing that's just there. And then you get this moment of like every episode he's like behind the main character at one moment and he's like moving closer and closer. And then you have a two episodes of him revealing himself. But like that idea that he's been there this entire time. So you get that moment of this character looking back and you realize that he's looking back at actual footage of the old episodes and you're like freaking out because you didn't notice it, that kind of
See, that would be fantastic. I think that we should start writing for Gotham, even though
thing.
it's a fantastic show. We could make it better.
But
No.
going back to Jerome specifically, what I was hoping was that he wasn't a red herring joker, was that he was the first person to be exposed to, like, okay, going back to what I said about Scott Snyder's Joker a few weeks back, about how I thought that the Joker could just be different people, like there could be different jokers in
The
time,
malevolent,
and that you said that they were born out of Gotham as sort of like a tuning fork. This would be cool if this was the first example of that
Of
something's
a
come to
Joker,
Gotham. That something is manifesting in the people of Gotham and turning them into something else. And the Joker's the ultimate version of that. But this is like
This is, yeah,
Gotham's getting crazier.
okay, so you know how, you said that, right? The joke, what made the Joker, okay, what made that malevolent being the Joker was the vat of chemicals. You know what I mean? But this character would be basically the Joker with a, yeah, fuck, I don't know how to explain it, but you know what I mean. I'm agreeing with you.
So I mean, again, I don't know if I can trust them to get that. You have your trust in them. I will continue to watch now and see. I did like this episode more than the other episodes.
I still think that you really need to watch the
I do. I
Scarecrow.
need to watch the second half.
That actually, that was very, it was a very good two-parter. It was really
The
good.
Scarecrow episodes, yeah.
Yeah.
So moving forward, they did show us a teaser of the Red Hood gang. I'm very excited to see what that
Oh yeah,
means.
especially after reading or finishing Year Zero. Fuck,
Yeah.
I'm excited for
I
that.
think
It
we will be
looks
seeing
great.
something closer to Zero Year.
Yeah. With the
I'm honestly
forcing
surprised
people
Gotham
into
hasn't
Red
gone for Court of Owls yet. Like, really? Like, it fits so perfectly.
But they're trying to do their own thing. So far, the only thing that they've really stuck to in the comics was making, well, it was the death of the Waynes.
Yeah.
And
I
not
will
even the
say,
influence
the
that
reason I
they.
liked this episode was finally I saw that they weren't going for the comics. Like, at first, the reason I was pissed at them is that every moment they were shoving down your throat that these were these comic book characters.
Yeah.
And now, even though they're still doing that, they're admitting they're doing their own versions of them.
Yeah, they're doing their own thing, which, yeah, I could it makes sense why they're not doing Court of Owls. You know what I mean? Because they're trying to establish that this isn't really like the comic books, and if you set your expectations to like, oh, it's gonna be the Court of Owls, you're gonna get disappointed because it's not gonna be, they're
Well, I
obviously
mean,
doing their
I
own
just
thing.
mean that the Court of Owls as a character makes so much sense because they didn't exist with, they existed before Batman.
Yeah, no,
So
I know what you mean.
for that
I was just
reason
saying in
alone.
general, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
But yeah, I
definitely.
think the Court of Owls would be fantastic. I think I said that our first podcast that having Bruce go missing for a week would just be awesome. It'd be an awesome
Yeah.
direction for the show. But
Definitely.
I'm still convinced that either the end of the season, it'll flash forward to like 10 years, right? And it'll be like Batman running on the rooftops and then like for what, a minute, and then it'll end. Like that'll be the end of the season, right? Either
Yeah.
that, like it'll time skip and show like a little teaser of what might happen in the future,
Well,
or
I think
the
I've agreed with
entire,
you on this before. Gotham should jump forward every
into
season.
every season, at least like what, 5 years,
To
so
me, it
that,
should happen at the end of the season finale should end, and then we get this 2 minute sort of not teaser, but sort of scene from the next season that's sort of like a time jump. And so for the first one, what I want it to be is that so the season ends with however it ends. I can't even speculate because I don't watch enough of it, but it ends. And then I imagine us seeing like, 5 months later appears on the screen, and we always see is sort of like a pan up of the GCPD building. And we see like people running around. They're talking about like various cases and stuff. And it sets up all this new stuff of just, you know, some of the crazy things that are happening in Gotham just really quickly without
and
going.
And then Gordon.
And then we
turns
see Gordon walk in. And he's got a mustache.
Little peach fuzz.
Yeah. No, he's got to have a fucking mustache.
No, I'm thinking peach fuzz, like a little, like a small little 14-year-old boy with a little mustache.
He's got the puberty stash.
Yeah, he's got the puberty stash.
And he's wearing the glasses.
Yeah, I just want
to. I'm actually okay if they wait on the glasses as like a thing of age, but
no,
give us
they,
the fucking
said,
mustache.
No, what he said about the mustache is that the mustache is like a, it's a mantle that he needs to earn, you know? Like,
it's a mustache. Hair on your upper lip.
No, the way he described it is like, oh, it shows maturity and it shows like it's a big part of who that character is. So
yeah, I agree.
He needs to like grow into his mustache, you know what I mean?
I agree. And right now he isn't there. I will admit that he's not there.
He's getting there though.
Eh.
Yeah, you haven't seen enough episodes.
I will say I liked him in this episode a lot more. Yeah. Okay, so really quickly, I just got to talk about, I didn't have that many issues with this episode, but there's just a few that were just weird to me.
Yeah.
And I just need to talk about them. So first one, what the fuck is going on with Selena Kyle and Ivy Pepper?
Okay,
and
so what you haven't seen is that yeah, like we all know, Selena Kyle is a thief and a fucking burglar,
yeah,
all that stuff. She in the earlier episodes, I forgot what happened to Gordon. I think Gordon left out of Gordon wasn't at his house, basically. Selena and Bruce break in and basically squat there, right? Like they're staying there and they're hiding out for a while, mainly mm-hmm. because it's behind this huge clock tower. So, you know, oh, you've seen how his window has like that clock.
Yeah, yeah, no, I know where it is, which is, again, really weird.
Yeah, it's a weird, but basically.
What does his wife do for, or not, sorry, his, was she even his fiance or were they just boyfriend and girlfriend? I was so confused by that.
No, they were just boyfriend and girlfriend. And
okay, what does she do for a living?
I don't know, but they started showing less and less of her. Like,
because it seemed like she just got high every day.
Yeah, she eventually was gone for like at least four episodes,
mm-hmm.
five episodes.
So she comes back. I gathered that they broke up.
Yeah.
Because he's dating Leslie now, and so, but what really was weird to me, it wasn't that they were staying there, it's that she was just okay with it.
Yeah, like, she was just like, oh, all right.
She's just like, this is what's happening, and then she, like,
but
starts...
maybe she's, you know, it could have been lazy
writing.
She's lonely,
I guess.
It could have been lazy writing, like, oh, she was high while she walked in. She's like, oh, I don't think I give a shit enough to, like, question really what's going on, you know?
It was just weird.
It was weird. But yeah, that's the reason
Selena Kyle and Ivy
are
there.
Yeah, Selena Kyle breaks in there and squats, and then she figures out that it's Gordon's place.
Mm-hmm.
And throughout the entire season, you know, before that happened, she and Gordon had this, like, not relationship, like, you know, Selena, you need to tell me if you know anything. And then
yeah,
Selena
no, I know.
Like,
I saw
oh,
the
yeah,
first
come episode. Here. You know, check this out. And then she'll fucking, like, leave him there. You know, like,
yeah,
have that weird relationship. And,
cat and mouse.
Yeah, and basically that's how it's played out in the
yeah.
season, you know? So he'll come home and it'll be like, Selena, and then, yeah. You get
okay,
it.
So I have three more things about Gotham. Next one, really quickly, I'll go through it quickly. Where is Fish? What is going on with Fish Mooney?
Okay, no
what
one,
is this place that's harvesting
no
people's
one
organs?
No knows. It's weird. No. Oh, I think I know. Okay.
Well, I'm assuming it's the doll maker.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, I'm pretty sure it's the doll maker. I don't, like, know exactly, like, oh, it's underground. Well, clearly it's underground.
Yeah.
Oh, it's here, it's there, you know. No one knows. Yeah. But basically, she was kidnapped, and she's, yeah, she runs this
okay.
crew underground now. That's it, really.
See, like, I like the idea of the doll maker doing something like this, but it's the most mismanaged thing I've ever seen.
How so?
Because what prisoners, like, can start a revolution so quickly? And the way they do it is so haphazard. Like, she's like,
yeah,
we'll just keep killing our own members. Like, eventually you're just gonna run out of people and it won't really matter.
And
like, or they'll just keep...
it'll just be Fish.
Yeah. Like, or they'll just keep getting new people and you won't make it, be making a dent. So either way, this is not a good idea. And then second of all, like, they just agree to her terms when they have guns?
Yeah, I know. It could have been handled better, but
yeah.
I don't watch the show for Fish. I watch it for other characters.
Okay, so that was just a really quick thing. It didn't take away from the rest of the episode too much, so I didn't have a big issue with it.
But like you said, it was better than a lot of the other
episodes. So my other thing is Bruce going to Wayne Enterprises was cool, him bringing his composition book was a little weird. And then
he's a fucking kid. Come on.
Okay, but then he's like, you guys have been doing fraud and, you know, working with criminals and stuff. And it's like, you're a little fucking 10-year-old coming into this building and telling them they're doing their job wrong. Like, maybe you're right, but where do you get off?
It's Bruce Wayne. What the fuck? What's your other complaint?
Okay. Okay, well, then really quickly, just on top of that. And then, like, Alfred is like, don't be afraid. Or don't come to me if we get dead in a ditch somewhere. It's like, the kid's parents were killed in front of him. Jesus Christ. Be a little more sensitive. Okay, but then the last thing I wanted to touch on was the weird thing with Zaz and Penguin reintroducing one of, Falcone's guys? Or, sorry, Fish's guys.
Fish's guys, yeah. Butch. Okay, so
my problem wasn't with what they were doing. Apparently he's brainwashed or he's just conditioned or something like that.
I think he's conditioned. Okay, because you know how Fish Mooney's in that one weird, basically doll maker's fucking doll museum or whatever. I don't know. I tried coming up with something clever. While they were trying to escape a shootout with Joker, no, not with Joker, with Zaz at Penguin's club, right?
Yeah.
While they were trying to escape a shootout, Butch let her escape, right? Like, oh, okay, here, go this place.
Yeah.
I'll try to hold them off. And that was like 5 episodes ago.
Okay.
Maybe I could be wrong, but they don't show him after that. They just show okay. Zaz walking up to.
So just really quickly, I just want to say I don't have an issue with the story element to it. My issue was the way they presented it. Was that okay? So he's like, turn around, and then there's like this dramatic music, and then we just see him standing there, and it's like he's just a guy, but the Penguin's like, ah! And he's just standing there, just looking at you.
Penguin knows that.
I understand, but like, it was so anti.
Show's perfect. Shut up.
And then they keep doing it, where they keep showing you him, and Penguin's like, ah! And
moving on. So, the Huntress was, the Huntress cut out of season 3 of
Okay,
Arrow,
so I didn't hear about this. So, what is this?
The Huntress was cut out of season 3 of Arrow.
Is that it?
I think so.
Did they expand on their plans that they were going to have?
I didn't look into it because I can't say that I don't care, but I haven't seen the any of season 3, so I don't care.
Okay, but you did watch season 1 and 2?
Yeah, I did.
Okay, so you know the Huntress character in the show.
Yeah, I kind of didn't like her character.
Yeah, I mean, you weren't really supposed to.
Yeah.
She was sort of a villain.
That was also another reason why I didn't really care. I was like, oh.
Yeah, so I mean, to be honest, there's no need for her right now. I think that there's a million other characters they can introduce that would, you know, I don't know. I don't know what their plans were for her, so I can't really be upset about it.
Yeah.
So on the note of Arrow, can I just talk about Arrow really quick for last week's episode?
Yeah, go ahead. And by the way, we're not going to be talking about this week's episode because today is Tuesday. Yeah, Tuesday, February 17th, 6:21. The show hasn't even aired yet. This is like a first. This is a first for us where we're not going to have a new opinion on the new episode. So by the time you're watching this, we're going to be talking about the previous episode of Arrow and Flash.
Yeah.
So yeah, just keep that in mind.
So by the time this goes up, Arrow will probably be that night.
Yeah.
So just last week's episode of Arrow was actually the finale in the Canary trilogy. Well, not the finale, but the finale in the three episodes that were, you know, the origin of Laurel becoming Black Canary. Yeah. So Ollie is back as the Green Arrow. He's not okay with Laurel as Black Canary. The episode is really about him learning to accept it. A few spoilers. Sarah returns. Now, before you get mad, she doesn't actually return. Vertigo escapes from prison, and his version of Vertigo in the show, especially in season 3, is, and this is a new Count Vertigo, this isn't the same Count Vertigo from the previous two seasons, is basically fear gas. He's basically Scarecrow.
Okay.
So when he injects someone with his Vertigo, they see him as their worst fear. And for Laurel, that's Sarah. But a Sarah who doesn't approve of her being Black Canary and thinks that she's doing it in a disrespectful way. So she gets beat up by Sarah. And it's this great fight between the two of them.
Interesting.
Ultimately, she does win. And basically, by the end of the episode, spoilers, Oliver accepts it and more than accepts it, sort of like is impressed by her. And it's really cool because she's really cool as like. I didn't like Laurel, and now I love her.
No one really wanted to like like
and
her.
they did it She's so cool now. A few other things. Thea is told about Oliver's secret.
Yeah, I saw that.
Her,
I saw
he
that
tells
promo.
Her his secret. It's great because it's like the last person that like really doesn't know. Obviously, Detective Lance still doesn't know, but at this point, he doesn't need to know. Like he knows enough that, you know, it doesn't really matter. But Thea was the one that was always pissing me off because she should just figure it out. Her dad is fucking Malcolm Merlin, you know, like there's all these things that just how
so
do you not know by now?
That she
and the best part was that when she finds out, she's like relieved. Like, it's not that stupid. You lied to me bullshit. Like, she's like, you were saving people this entire time. All those stupid lies you told me were because you were saving people's lives.
Yeah.
And it's like, that's cool. Like, that's so cool to me. That
they
she
could
just...
have gone, they could have gone the other route and made it fucking shitty. Like, how could you do this? And then fucking...
It was so great to me. Like, they just... It made me cry almost because, like... Not because, like... I mean, it was emotionally impacting, but that was... But it made me cry just because, like, we get to save ourselves from this melodrama. Like,
so, wait. So, it did make you cry?
Yeah.
You're a little bitch. No, just kidding.
I admit it. but, yeah. Other than that, there's a... I'm trying to think of what else is on Arrow this week. It was a great episode, but, like... It, you know, everything else was also great, so I'm just sort of all over the place. But yeah, it was a great episode. I'm very excited for this week's. I'm trying to think of what this week's is about. Who knows? I'm excited.
Yeah, either way, you're excited. Now,
yeah.
Let's talk about Flash.
All right.
I can't really remember. It feels like it's been forever, dude. Was it Peekaboo?
No. This one was...
I remember. It was...
This is...
Firestorm,
okay. The nuclear man.
Yeah. That one was great. It was a really good episode. I know this is going to sound weird. I think that Robbie Amell, who's obviously Stephen Amell's cousin who plays Arrow, I think he's a better actor.
Here's the thing. This is what I wanted to talk about. I think he is a good actor. I think they're both good actors. But when he talks, he sounds like Stephen Amell, especially when he exclaims, when he's like yelling. When he's like, I can't let all those people die. Like, it's like, it sounds like Arrow. Like,
I didn't hear it. I don't know. Maybe because I wasn't paying attention to it.
And maybe it's because you watched the episode of, now for me, this could just be, I watched Arrow on Wednesday and then I had to wait till Friday to watch The Flash. So I had Arrow more in my head. But like, watch an episode of Arrow, then watch Robbie Amell. And it's so crazy because it sounds like it's there. It's so there. It's not there enough where it's like the exact same voice, but you can tell they're the same the same blood, you know?
Yeah. Now,
But about this week's episode of Flash, did you have any thoughts on it? Because I do.
I don't really remember. Oh, actually, yeah.
Well, there was a big thing.
I didn't like the end scene.
Okay, the end scene was really anticlimactic, but it wasn't bad. It's just that, this was after Grodd was the last
episode. Oh, yeah, so I mean...
So our expectations were a bit high.
That. Yeah.
It was just General Eiling pretty much saying they need Firestorm.
Oh, there's Firestorm, we gotta get him.
Yeah.
It felt really fast, too.
I think that's why
I was underwhelmed.
To be honest, it wasn't even really an end credit scene. They should have just had it before.
I was like, shit, is that it?
Yeah. But the big thing was the entire episode, Cisco and Joe West are at the house where Barry's mother was killed.
Yes, the entire time
they're looking for evidence, and they end up managing to recreate images from that night. And this leads them to discover that there is a blood stain on the wall of one of the speedsters, because we now know there were two speedsters there that night. And obviously, we both kind of knew who those two speedsters were.
Reverse Flash and the Flash.
But
give away the identity.
This week, we got the confirmation that Cisco, like, they said it. They confirmed it. You know, they know it to themselves now. Barry Allen from, at least a grown-up version of Barry Allen, so a time-traveling version of Barry Allen, was there. And that's crazy.
That's huge. That is huge. That's basically what? Flashpoint?
Yeah.
It's basically Flashpoint.
And I've said this before. I think that, maybe not on the podcast, but I've said this to you before, Julian. I think that the season could end with not Flashpoint per se, but basically an alternate timeline being born for season two.
That's interesting. I haven't read Flashpoint, and I don't know much about it, so I can't really expand or, you know, complain about that. But it does sound interesting, and it does sound awesome. And I know that... Fuck, what's tonight's episode?
Tonight's 14th? Episode is the part two of the Nuclear Man, so we're continuing
on. Is that episode 14 or 15?
Yikes.
Because I do know that in episode 15 it's a time travel episode.
Then it's episode 15, I believe.
Okay, yeah.
Because I think Robbie, they said that Firestorm story.
In the synopsis, they said that. Fuck, I think it's Dr.
So now
Stein.
I'm really pumped.
Yeah, so we got another hour and 30 minutes. So tonight's episode is going to be great. I don't have much more to discuss about The Flash. I don't know.
Okay, can I just say one more thing? Because I was super excited about last
week. Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, so two really quick things. One, fucking love Martin Stein being in Robbie Amell's body for the beginning of it. Yeah. Like, I love that that's how they introduced him. So that wasn't like, I don't know. I'm really excited to see how that they expand on that. Two, what was I trying to say? Moving on with time travel and having season two be an alternate future. My thinking is that season one will have Barry go back in time.
Yeah.
And we'll see the fight with him in Reverse Flash, you know, at his mother's death. And when he returns to the, like, so what I'm thinking is the Barry that's there is the Barry in the last episode of season one.
Okay.
So when he returns to the present, it's different. Does that make sense?
No, it makes sense. It makes sense.
So this is all leading up to him going back in time to save his mom. So we don't know what happens after that point.
I mean, hell. Well, no, I don't know. Didn't really have much of a thought there. Well, I had a thought and then I lost the thought. So yeah, go on.
Okay, because, like, to me, like, him saving his mom, like, once they find out he can time travel, isn't that what he would want to do?
Oh, so, yeah, he would want to go back and save his mom. But.
And we know that the writers have told us the Reverse Flash's endgame is the end of the season. So to me, that screams Barry will chase him back in time. They will have their fight. Maybe this is all his plan, is to get him to that fight even. And, we don't know what version of Reverse Flash was there. Maybe Reverse Flash was from the future too at that point. I mean, obviously it was, but you know what I mean?
It was me, Barry.
Like, I'm just so, there's so many fucking possible things that it's crazy. But I think ultimately when we get to season two, time will have been altered. Now it might not stay that way, but like time will have been altered for the first part of it and Barry will have to figure it out.
I think season one should be Reverse Flash. And that's it. I think that the Reverse Flash arc should be wrapped up with season one.
I agree. I don't mind if they don't kill Reverse Flash. Like, I wouldn't be. I would be fine if he sort of takes a.
If they kill him, it would be okay, because in the comics there have been two
multiple
Reverse Flashes.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know. Maybe there's two prominent ones. I don't know how many in total. But
okay. Can I? You know what would be interesting?
What?
So we know that Eddie Thwain is not named that by coincidence.
Eddie Thawne,
sorry. Yeah. I like Thwain, but Thawne is the correct pronunciation. Okay, Eddie Thawne is not named that for coincidence.
No.
What if they kill Harrison Wells' Reverse Flash, but they don't find out that he is indeed Eddie Thawne in the past? Like, you know, that he becomes Harrison Wells. And
so you think that Eddie Thawne becomes Harrison Wells?
Well, okay, maybe even not that case, but like that just, you know, something along those lines. I do think right now, I think that if Eddie Thawne is Reverse Flash, it's because he becomes Harrison Wells. Now, obviously it's a stretch because I can't see him becoming Harrison Wells, but there's ways to do it. But, but like just that, I could see that like they kill Harrison Wells, they think it's over. But to me, the Reverse Flash is sort of like the Flash's Ultron. He is ultimately his end. He is ultimately, you know, his sparring partner for the end of time. Now, that doesn't mean he needs to be the villain of every season. But moving forward, we see Eddie Thawne get there. And we don't. And no one knows it. No one sort of, you know, is thinking that. So we see him move towards Reverse Flash. And all the other characters are like, you know, they don't realize it. But then we get that episode where it happens. And, okay, sorry.
Either way.
Many thoughts on The Flash that
either way,
that's its own podcast.
I'm looking forward to tonight's episode. I'm looking forward to what? There's, I think, seven
however
seven episodes
many more.
Left. Yeah. That's it, really, for TV news. And
I have another thing I want to talk about really quick.
Another thing? All right,
sorry.
No, it's okay.
I'm going to be really quick about it. Tonight is the finale for Agent Carter. Last week's episode was fantastic. We got to see her beat up an entire team of S.H.I.E.L.D. agents in a diner. It was great. So yeah, moving forward with the Black Widow story.
So tonight is the last episode?
I believe the last episode.
Well, I think there's going to be a huge Easter egg to look out for then. I think that's James, I think the actor who plays Jarvis, I could be wrong. Mm-hmm. He said that there's a huge Easter egg to look out for. Huge, 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 that any Marvel fan would recognize. So
I'm very excited for that.
Yeah.
All right. Do you want to take the reins here?
Taking the reins. Now it's time for, you know, big topic of the week. Spider-Man is joining the MCU.
Eh? I was joking. He is dead and reborn. Here lies Peter Parker, but still it's unknown, because Spider-Man still survives and he still fights crime. But I don't think he's the same as he was before. Spider-Man's back in the MCU.
Well, or he's not back.
He's in it for the first time.
He's in it for the first time. Fuck, where do we start, dude? Where do we start? There's so many.
Okay, first of all, Spider-Man is in Marvel Studio. Is in the Marvel Cinematic Universe.
Spider-Man exists. With Captain America, with Daredevil. I'm just more excited that he exists with Daredevil. I want to see so many buddy.
We all know that you were happy about Daredevil. We all know you got a fucking hard on for Daredevil.
Hey, shut your mouth about Daredevil.
It's okay, I do too.
Yeah, I want to see, you know, Spider-Man appear in Daredevil. I want to see Spider-Man appear in Civil War. They're saying that, you know, that might be his first appearance.
Yeah.
But I don't want to talk about what we know.
Okay,
make sense?
Yeah, that's fine.
Like, we'll address it, but I don't want
to... Yeah, let's talk more about, like, theories and what this could lead to.
Exactly, exactly.
Okay, but now, before we do that, can we just take a minute? Because this is huge. Like, I know we've had a week to process it now, but this is, like, this is the thing. This is the thing that since the dawn of Iron Man, and we knew that these movie rights existed...
It's what
even before that,
asked for.
Yeah, everyone. This is what every fan wanted, and we all thought would never happen just because we wanted it so badly. Like, there's been a million Latino review posts of Spider-Man being back in the Marvel Universe, or being theorized to be back in the Marvel Universe, or the Sony hacks leading to Spider-Man being back in the Marvel Universe.
Yeah.
You know, all of these things. And then they just did it.
And then it just happens. I know that you were very skeptical for some reason.
I was so skeptical.
I'm not sure why. All the emails were there. Like, everything was
there. Well, don't
get
me wrong. I think that was when we started to get the first concrete evidence. So
yeah.
My skepticism, I'd like to say, was from all of these rumors or speculation or things like, oh, Spider-Man was in the Civil Wars comics, so that means they got to get him back. Like, things like that that just were grabbing or reaching or just had no, you know,
Either way, it's happening.
It's happening.
And people are saying, well, the huge suspicion is that his first appearance is going to be in Civil War. I don't know how they could handle it. It's not confirmed, but that's just what, you know, people are jumping to because, yeah, it's the next movie to be filmed by Marvel.
Yeah.
And it'll be the best way to introduce a new Spider-Man fast, you know?
Yeah.
And then set him up in his new, I think it's July 18th. July 17th, yeah. 2018, or July 18th, 2017?
Civil War?
Film. No,
his solo film.
Solo film. Solo film, yeah.
Yeah, and the great thing about that is it'll be produced by Kevin Feige, the head of Marvel Studios.
The dude who came up with the whole... Who came up with the MCU.
Yeah.
The guy who made it all happen, you know?
This is what makes this deal so fucking crazy. And I just needed... I know we're going to talk about things we don't know, but really on the things we do know, this deal is ridiculous. This deal means... Sony, okay, so for those of you who don't know, basically, Sony and Marvel have agreed to combine their talent without trading money. So basically, the Marvel movies that include Spider-Man, Sony will take no cut from. The Sony movies that include Marvel characters, Marvel will take no cut from. They are still making their own films, you know, that they make their own money off of, that they have to finance themselves. Basically, all this means is Marvel Studios now has a second studio that has more money.
Exactly. The thing is that they're both not getting anything from it, like from each other, you know what I mean? But it's the
obviously
boost.
The money will be there because the fans want this. So it's genius. It's just weird. It's unprecedented. But then the other thing is that, like, as I said, with Kevin Feige producing Spider-Man, it means it's not just like them teaming up. It's them letting Marvel take the reins on their Spider-Man.
Yeah, exactly. And they're letting Marvel is offering not creative control, but like help.
Creative rights, I guess.
Yeah, creative rights. Like, oh, look, this is how you got to do it. You don't make it a sappy, love story with fucking, you know, yeah, it's great. It's great that this is actually happening. It's fantastic. It's every word in the book. It's fucking illustrious. Yeah. It's great.
Okay, so now that I've gotten to say that, I'll let you move on to how you wanted to handle this topic.
Okay, now, I mean, the other topics we've talked about, it's basically, well, we don't know much right now. That's all we really know. All we really know. So let's talk about what we don't know. Let's talk about what we want to know. Let's talk about what we want to happen. Now, first, let's talk about Spider-Man himself, like his actual characterization. How do you want him to be introduced? Do you want him to
so
be
we know
a kid?
He won't be Andrew Garfield.
It won't be Andrew Garfield. He asked. Okay. I think he asked, and they had meetings, but no. Unfortunately, okay. No. Do you want an adult Spider-Man? Do you want a teenage Spider-Man? How do you want it to be taken care of?
Okay, so I'm of two minds. Ultimately, I want them to go with teenage Spider-Man because I think that's what they want to go with. And I want them to, you know, play to what they want from Spider-Man. I want Marvel to do what, you know, I know this sounds weird. I want Marvel to do what they want.
Yeah.
But considering he will be in the same universe now as the Avengers, I would love an adult Spider-Man just because it makes him on that playing ground more, you know, like it makes him more accessible to that.
Yeah.
But I think ultimately I want teenage Spider-Man.
Now me, on the other hand, I want adult Spider-Man. I want high school professor. I want,
God, that'd be so
great.
Was
he a high school professor or was he a college professor?
He was a high school professor.
He was a professor. I want high school
and
professor
then he was
Spider-Man,
a scientist.
And then he was a scientist. Yeah, I want adult, fully grown, knows his shit. I could see why they won't do that because, I mean, what, we already have Tony Stark and
Hank Pym
and Bruce Banner as the creative
see,
minds.
See, that's why I always like Marvel, is that all of their, like, most powerful characters are scientists.
Smart. Like, they didn't, yeah. I would want an adult Spider-Man. If not a, like, he doesn't need to be a scientist, but a high school professor would be good, you know? Mm-hmm. Maybe have Flash Thompson as the gym coach. You know?
See, now that you say it, like, Spider-Man adult, if they could do the Horizon Labs route where he's already, like, a scientist,
yeah,
that'd be great to have Peter Parker be their version of Reed Richards, essentially.
That'd be fantastic. That'd
because
be
they can't have the Fantastic...
They can't.
Yeah, because they can't have the Fantastic Four yet, but they got Spider-Man, so, like, yeah.
They could swap characteristics and stuff like that.
Yeah.
All right.
I just... Yeah.
Now, who would you like... I already have my choice who I want to play Spider-Man. Well, I got two ideas. Who would you like to play?
I think we've actually talked about this on the podcast before, or maybe just in person, of who we'd want to play Peter Parker if it wasn't Andrew Garfield. Now, I love Andrew Garfield. I thought he was a great Spider-Man.
He did a good job.
You didn't like those films as much as
I didn't like the films. I do think that he was a good Spider-Man. It's just the stuff that he was given, you know?
Yeah. Though I do think in Amazing Spider-Man 2, so far, that's the best visualization of Spider-Man we've seen
definitely,
in film so far.
Yeah.
So I hope that it looks and sort of feels like that, just at least Spider-Man himself. So acting-wise, if we're going to go adult, my choice right now, obviously I haven't done research on this. This is just off the top of my head. I'm going Jake Gyllenhaal.
Yeah, he was going to be Spider-Man in Spider-Man 2. You knew that, right?
Yeah, I did not know that, and I
would love that. Yeah, he was gonna play Peter Parker once Tobey Maguire injured his back filming a movie.
Can we just go back? We have to go back.
Marty, it's your kids. I think he'd be great. Now, that's for the adult route.
Yeah, for the adult
right?
Spider-Man.
What about high school Spider-Man?
Okay, so. High school Spider-Man. Now, here's the thing.
Okay.
If they do go high school Spider-Man, can they just do this? Can they just have adult Peter Parker and then high school Miles Morales? Like, in the same movie?
So, two Spider-Men? Is that what... Is that...
Just call it Spider-Men and, like...
No, I think that the first adaptation, or the first Marvel...
They said it was Peter Parker, I know.
Yeah, no, I'm saying that the first way that they introduce it, just go fucking Spider-Verse. Fuck it.
Oh, God, yes.
That was a joke, by the way. Don't get too excited.
Give Spider-Gwen a film. Emma Stone? How cool would that be?
Either one.
Okay.
About high school, I don't know much young actors.
No, but think about it. think about it. Spider-Verse explaining like why the previous Spider-Man movie isn't in continuity anymore.
That was actually, I think that was a comparison, an idea that they had in the Sony emails.
Like, it doesn't need to be as crazy. Just like, anyway.
No, but they were going to have in the Sony emails, I'm pretty sure, maybe I'm wrong, but they wanted to have Tobey Maguire versus Andrew Garfield, I think.
Okay, well, I'm glad that didn't happen because, like, Tobey Maguire, no more Toby. Viva la Spider-Gwen.
Jesus Christ. All right.
Okay, so back to Peter Parker.
Back to casting Peter Parker.
I know a lot of people have been wanting a not-white Peter Parker.
Oh,
and
yeah, Donald.
To be honest, if they go high school route, I want a not-white Peter Parker.
Yeah, if they go high school route. Now, I would... Okay, Donald Glover is a name that's always tossed around when it comes to Spider-Man. Always.
Yeah.
For those who know,
yeah,
he's a comedian. He's also a rapper named Childish Gambino. Yeah, awesome. Fucking awesome.
We're all fans of him.
Oh, yeah.
My girlfriend's a huge fan of him.
There's... Whenever they talk about him, it's always Miles Morales. But why can't he play Peter Parker?
Okay, now that's the thing, is everybody talks about him as Miles Morales just because he's black. Yeah. Obviously, he's more Peter Parker.
Yeah, he's
you know,
much more Peter Parker than
he's a kid
Miles
from
Morales.
Queens who, like, I mean, he's so Peter Parker.
Yeah. So if well, I guess I have three. He's a top contender. I would like him as Peter Parker, mainly because, you know, he'd play him great. You know?
Yeah. Now here's the thing, he wouldn't be high school Peter Parker.
No, definitely.
You would have
not.
To be
no,
at least college.
Or professor? No.
I would
nah,
love
not professor,
that
not professor.
So much though. Donald yeah, Glover as like a scientist Peter Parker, a racist would hate it, and I would love it.
He'd be great. He'd be a great Peter Parker.
He would be. Now my thought is, I don't remember the actor's name, and I feel really bad about that because he's won Oscars and shit. But the kid from Slumdog Millionaire.
Oh, fuck. Yeah, I'm picturing him right now. But no, I don't know.
I could
know
see him either. As... Now, obviously, he's a little too old now, but when he was first doing that, high school Peter Parker, that would have been awesome.
Oh, yeah. All right. Would you like to hear my choices?
Yeah, sure. Definitely. Go for it.
All right. So, first off, yes, I'll say Donald Glover. Mm-hmm. Right? Talked about that. He's just got that Peter Parker charm and wit, you know. He'd be great. Another that I've always had this in mind, mainly because it's just his presence, right? Charlie Day as adult Peter Parker.
You just want Charlie Day to play everyone.
I do. No, well, I want Charlie Day to play like the fun.
Ryan Gosling can be Green Goblin.
Well, just wait until my next choice. I want Charlie Day. I want Charlie Day in a Marvel movie. I do.
I can tell.
He's got the attitude for it, you know. He's got that personality, that charm. I honestly think, and this isn't just me bullshitting, I think that he'd make a great Peter Parker. The fun-loving, you know, especially as he played Newt in...
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Pacific Rim, yeah. That was basically what I picture for, like, for high school teacher Peter Parker. You know what I mean?
I could see that. He's a little too cool.
At the same time, I'm a huge Charlie Day fan, so I can't... It could just be clouding my judgment, but that's...
I think Charlie Day is Deadpool to me. Like, if Ryan Reynolds wasn't Deadpool, Charlie Day would be Deadpool. So yeah, I can't really see him as Spider-Man, because I know everybody for some reason has this, like, thing for Deadpool and Spider-Man, but, like, those characters would hate each other. Like,
they would hate each other. They would not get along.
Even when they've met in comics, and everybody uses this as an example, they hate each other in those comics.
Yeah.
Because Spider-Man's whole thing is do not kill. Like, he's almost like Batman. Like, obviously, he's done it at points.
Yeah.
But he's almost like Batman, where, like, he hates people who kill. It took him the longest time to get over Wolverine. And he still doesn't like Wolverine all that much.
And dude, even working with Punisher, he fucking hates working with Punisher.
Yeah.
Hates it.
Not to mention Punisher's tried to kill him like more than
once. Dude, his first appearance is him trying to kill him.
Yeah.
Now
okay, so your next pick.
Shit, there was one that came Jake Gyllenhaal, really good idea. You know. It'd work. And
yeah.
My last one.
Don't say it.
Can you guess what it is?
Gilbert Gottfried.
Oh God,
Christopher Walken.
If I could do it, I would. If I could do an impression, I would.
It's me, your
No.
friendly neighborhood. No, I can't
No,
do it,
no,
Christopher
no,
Walken. Cut that out.
no.
For the sake of fans.
Ryan Gosling as an adult Spider-Man.
You can leave now.
No, I really could see it. I could see it. I
He's
don't
too
know why.
handsome.
Well, that's why he'd have the mask on, Antonio.
See, okay, here's the thing. One, I mean, ultimately, they're going to pick a white guy. Now, I don't say that because Marvel's, like, the reason I say this is because Marvel, they've wanted Spider-Man for so long. They've wanted Peter Parker from the comics to jump off the page for so long. Yeah. Now, Peter Parker in the comics can be any race. It's true. Spider-Man is supposed to be the everyman. He is every high school kid who's ever been bullied or, you know, put through a hard time. He's not white, you know, by definition.
Yeah.
But Marvel Studios is going to want that visual recognition of Peter Parker. And so they're going to want that shot of him next to the comic, and they're going to want to be able to go, that's Peter Parker from the comic, you know?
Yeah.
Like, I ultimately think they're going to go that route. I think that it's a huge possibility. I think almost like 100% positive we will see Miles Morales in the Marvel Cinematic Universe.
Really?
Maybe not in the first film, but I think that it is entirely irresponsible to think that we will not see a non-white Spider-Man in the Cinematic Universe.
But the only reason I do pick Ryan Gosling, it's not because I have a fucking huge Ryan Gosling hard on. That's not true, by the way. No, it's totally true. I'm a fan. Obviously, I'm a fan of him, but I really like when he plays.
Really?
I really like when he plays not dim-witted character, but sort of lighter, funnier characters.
Spider-Man is not dim-witted, though.
No. Like, I only say that in comparison to, like, because he's always playing like really heavy.
I see what you
like,
mean.
Emotional
I see.
Characters, you know.
Peter Parker is not the same character from Drive.
Hell no. But when shit. I'm
How great would that be?
I'm trying to think of a movie. In a Ryan Gosling movie. But yeah, when he plays lighthearted characters, he's funny, he's likable, all that stuff. And he'd make a good high school professor. Well, shit, how old is Ryan Gosling now? Ryan is in his 30s. I was going to say, Ryan could pull off the, oh shit, I'm super poor, but I'm also a superhero. That sort of funny kind
of...
Yeah, I
can see that.
Like, ah, shit.
So let me speak to an older Spider-Man really quick, because you know what? I wouldn't have thought this last year, but with Paul Rudd now playing Ant-Man and them taking this guy who is normally a comedic actor and not like a hunk really and turning him into a superhero. Adam Scott as an adult Peter Parker.
Yeah, that'd be perfect. That would also be freaking fantastic.
He could pull off he has the professor mentality already.
Actually,
but he's also
let me move on to my next choice.
Okay.
Adam Scott as adult Peter Parker. But
you
yeah,
fucker.
He'd be great. You've seen Parks and Recs, right?
Yeah, I love Parks and Recreation.
There you go. Just basically adapt that.
Like, I can't believe that. Just like that would be great. And as an
it
adult
would.
Paper.
It would. That trumps Ryan Gosling.
Okay, but I think they're gonna go with a high school Peter Parker.
Yeah. And I really when Amazing Spider-Man was being casted, Michael Angarino, I think.
I don't know him.
He was in fuck, nothing comes to mind. He was in a film called Gentlemen Broncos, directed by the same guy who directed Napoleon Dynamite and Nacho Libre. That dude's an awesome actor. Fuck. What else? Yeah, he's a great actor. If I show you a photo of him, you'll recognize him and be like, oh yeah, I've seen him. I've seen what he's in. He would have made a great Peter Parker. He really would have. Other than that, I can't think of any young actors. I know one that comes to mind is Logan Lerman.
Yeah, well, they're actually, I think they said that they're looking at Logan Lerman.
They're looking at Logan Lerman and this other actor from that Google movie that came out. With Vince Vaughn and all that stuff. I forgot his name. But, yeah, I really wish that they wouldn't go with the high school route, but that's what they're going with.
Okay, so moving on from that, from Peter Parker, I mean.
Yeah.
So I'm going, as I said, we're going to just go forward assuming it's high school. And I say that just because they want Peter Parker. You know, they want that essence of Peter Parker. And to me, that screams high school Spider-Man, you know?
Oh, definitely.
And so what do you think for a first movie? Because I gotta say, we can't see another origin. They won't do that to us.
If they do that, it would be in Civil War. If he's actually being introduced in Civil War and they do give another origin story,
it would be in Civil War.
Yeah, I'd rather them do that and have it be like 5 minutes, you know, whatever. Okay. That'd be great. That'd be the best way for them to do it. If it's an after credit scene,
if the after credit scene was like, okay, so I don't know how they would tie this in, but he's at like Uncle Ben's grave, and like he's like clinging it, he's like grabbing it, and then he like breaks it a little to show us that like the you know, he's already gotten the powers.
Yeah, yeah.
And so it's like just to show us it happened, you know,
a little like a little sneak, yeah.
Yeah.
Or like he's been Spider-Man secretly, basically. I'd rather an established Spider-Man.
Or even just, yeah, even, like, as Civil War is happening, all this crazy shit is going on, he, like, uses his web shooters or something, or lifts up a car to save someone really quickly. Like,
yeah,
that's all we see.
It could be just a quick cameo. Okay, what I'm getting at is Civil War is the best way to introduce Spider-Man. It really is. It could be short, it could be sweet, it could get to the point, all that stuff. Mm-hmm. Now, for a solo film, clearly... They're doing high school again.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'm fine with them doing high school again, as long as they don't do it like the fucking Jesus, like Amazing Spider-Man 1, and you know.
Mm-hmm.
Clearly, they won't do it like that. But I don't want a lot.
I honestly expect a little bit more 21 Jump Street high school.
Yes, exactly. That's exactly like how I think of it, like Phil Lord, Chris Miller type of. Type of writing and stuff like that. I don't want love. I don't want a love story. I want Spider-Man to focus on being Spider-Man.
Mm-hmm. I will say I do want a new Gwen. Not a new Gwen Stacy, but I want Gwen Stacy. I don't want her to be a romantic interest, though. I want her to be like his friend, who's also really smart.
Unfortunately, I don't think they're going to do that because her death was shown, and it was like 2 years ago, last year.
Yeah. Yeah,
it's too soon. They might reintroduce.
No, I totally understand. Yeah. I want that character just because Mary Jane is an interesting character to me.
I want high school. Well, I don't want that, but if I'm thinking realistically, they're gonna go with high school Spider-Man, not in a relationship of any sort. Sort of antisocial. Show that he's like really smart. You know, sort of the underdog, all that stuff, and then. Villain wise, I really want Norman Osborn.
Yeah,
that's also I thought about this the other day. Norman Osborn can now exist in the fucking MCU,
right?
Do you know how huge that is? Like how much shit that means, dude.
Like Norman Osborn was the big bad guy of the Marvel Cinematic Universe for a good 5 years. Like exactly. He was as big as Doctor Doom for a while.
It was during the Siege and Dark Reign, right?
Yeah, like he took over S.H.I.E.L.D.
I desperately want a new Green Goblin, an actual Green Goblin, you know. But if we don't get that, then I could see them going with either Shocker or Mysterio.
Okay, can I just speak to that really
quick?
Yeah,
go ahead.
Okay, so now that I'm thinking about it, they can use elements of adult Spider-Man in teenage Spider-Man. How cool would it be? Okay, so I don't know if you know this, in the Amazing Spider-Man run by Dan Slott before Superior. Peter was working at this awesome think tank built by a guy named Max Modell called Horizon Labs.
Yeah.
Basically, to be honest, the Big Hero 6 is more based on that to me than the actual Big Hero 6 comic books.
Interesting.
Like, that's what it feels like. It feels like that really high-tech lab of goofy high schoolers who, you know, are building weird inventions. So why not just have it be goofy high schoolers building weird inventions and Peter Parker be offered that because he's obviously smarter. So why do this again where we put him through this mediocrity of high school where we can have high school be cool and fun again and like different. And so have him be in this sort of Willy Wonka meets Reed Richards kind of think tank. And that opens so many doors for villains and characters and stuff because you could have other tech-powered heroes be students there. You could have villains be people who work in this lab, not as teachers, so you don't go that hokey route, but they work there, and so they interact with them. So you could have, you could even have Norman Osborn be a primary financier of the lab.
Yeah. Now, what I really love about this is basically the possibilities. Like, I'll get into it right now. But the thing that's crazy is that, so when Sony still wanted, I don't know if they still want to, but Sony wanted to create the Sinister Six, the female, the Spider-Woman, you know, spin-off, all that stuff. They wanted to spin off and branch out and build this universe, right?
They want to build their Spider-Man cinematic universe.
Yeah, now that Spider-Man is in the Marvel Cinematic Universe, they don't need to make all of those movies. They want to make a Venom spin-off, have Guardians of the Galaxy deal with the symbiote in an after-credit scene. You know what I mean?
Yeah, but we do know Sinister Six is moving forward. We're still getting film.
I still hope that secretly...
It's superior foes. I do too.
It's not gonna.
You know
be.
What? Okay. Charlie, like, can we just, as you said, there's Charlie Day.
It's
like,
Charlie Day needs to be in something.
Get all of the It's Sunny cast and just make them the Sinister.
I've talked to you about this.
Yeah, you've told me this millions of times. It's genius. This is their time.
D would be a Beetle.
My only issue with that is that finally we had a team with like good diversity on it, so it would just be a bunch of white guys. But like, don't get me wrong, they'd be great, but you know what I mean. Like,
yeah, I know.
It's kind of weird. It's worse, I think, when they make an ethnic character white in a movie, because, you know, there's so few of them to begin with. But I won't go in too much into that now. I think that Superior Foes would be great no matter how they did
it. Got it. So yeah, apparently, you know, they're still moving on with Sinister Six. But, like I said, it could be less convoluted now that they have... I mean, Sony could... how do I say this? Sony... It benefits Sony that, like, yeah, Marvel has access to Spider-Man, but now Sony...
Now they don't have to worry.
It's like, the door opens both ways. You know what I mean?
Definitely,
So that means they... Okay, they want to make a Venom spinoff, like I said, have Guardians of the Galaxy. They land on the symbiote planet. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
They want to make a new origin for Spider-Man. Just have it be shown in Captain America Civil War, you know?
With a Venom spinoff, like, the thing is, the potential just wasn't there. I never liked Venom, villain Venom having his own series, because it's, at some point it gets boring. You know, like, you're just, why do we care about this guy who just has no moral compass?
I want to see Flash Thompson.
Exactly. Flash as Venom works as its own film. And the way they could do it, yes, they could introduce it with Guardians, but it doesn't need to be a Guardians film. It could be him in space on his own film, and that'd be still fun. Or it could be on him on Earth having his own film, and that would also be fun. But you know what I mean? Like, either way. But yeah, I think that Sinister Six is really interesting, because now I'm going to assume it's not Foes, just because we would never be that lucky. But then again, Spider-Man's back in the Marvel Cinematic Universe, so who knows?
I was thinking it could be Foes. It really could be.
But let's just pretend it's not Foes, just so that we're preparing ourselves. Let's prepare ourselves for the reality that it's not Foes. What do you think a Sinister Six movie would mean? Do you think it would be... Would it be a Sinister Six movie, or would it be a Spider-Man movie called Sinister Six?
I think it'd be a Sinister Six movie about four people who call themselves the Sinister Six.
You mean five?
Oh, yeah. One of them could be Dormammu. No. Okay, so I don't know how I feel about that. I could say that, it might not do good, because having all these characters introduced at once, you know, and they're all new... You know, have them.
But Marvel knows how to do that.
Exactly, with Guardians of the Galaxy.
We had Guardians of the Galaxy.
Yeah, so I can't say anything. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I think it'll be split 50-50. It'll be as much of a Spider-Man movie as it is a Sinister Six movie. But I think the Sinister Six are going to be portrayed as heroes, not heroes, but like. It's hard. Sort of like Suicide Squad.
See, moving on with what I said about Horizon Labs being like the high school thing and being financed by Norman Osborn. Yeah. Like, what if Norman Osborn builds the Sinister Six as his sort of official superhero team? Like, to sort of... Because, okay, let's just talk about Civil War for a second, what that means. Because it's not secret identities. So Civil War is keeping heroes in check, right?
Yeah.
Oh, I mean, like, that's what we're assuming. So what if that leads... basically companies to building superhero teams that are government issued, and Norman Osborn's is the Sinister Six.
I don't know. There's just so many ways. I mean, so many ways it could be played, you know?
Yeah.
Another thing I was thinking is, just have them be established. The thing about the Amazing Spider-Man films was that the villains were tied into Spider-Man.
Yeah.
You know, they were directly like a result of Spider-Man. But I mean, if they continue with the Sinister Six movie, they could, what they could do is just have them already established. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like,
and the
yeah,
thing that
have Mysterio be this, you know, you get it, you get it.
Yeah, and the power that Marvel has with Spider-Man is everybody knows Spider-Man.
Yeah,
you know, in the way that they had to build
up
Iron Man, Captain America, and all that, they don't need to do that with this.
They don't.
At all. Everybody knows these characters. Now, obviously, they'll introduce us to their versions, but we don't need to, like, say, okay, we know that's Doc Ock. The second we see his tentacles, we know it's Doc Ock. Keep moving forward, you know?
Yeah. I mean,
so like,
there's so many ways, so many different
speaking
ways.
Speaking of, I want Doc Ock to be the main villain.
Main villain?
Yeah.
Of the Sinister Six film?
No, of the Spider-Man movie.
Yeah, yeah. It's definitely,
I want
it's
Norman
about
Osborn
time.
To be in it, but I want Doc Ock to be the first main villain.
Yeah,
because
it's
he's
about
the
time.
Character who, in the comic world, he makes more sense to be Spider-Man's ultimate villain. Green Goblin makes sense to be a villain of, like, the Marvel Universe, especially
yeah,
the way
that,
they built him up.
As a whole, yeah.
Yeah. Like, he's up there with Doctor Doom, where Doctor Doom started out as, you know, a Fantastic Four villain, but became more than that. That, to me, is Green Goblin, where Doc Ock is the opposite of Spider-Man, you know?
Either way, we're just going to have to wait and see how
yeah.
it all plays out, you know?
And I'm so excited.
You know what? Other than that, I think that's it for the big topic of the week. Do you have anything else to say?
Spider-Gwen 2018?
yeah, Ryan Gosling for Spider-Man. No, but I hope you enjoyed this this podcast. You know, make sure to follow us on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, you know.
Instagram,
you know. It's
Gam-Gam's Instagram.
Gam-Gam-Gram. It's, yeah, follow us on all of our social media. And we should be updating... we should be updating the channel regularly. I know I said that last podcast, and that didn't do so good. But
just
yeah,
redefine your definition of regular.
We're trying. We're still new at this. But yeah, other than that, I hope you guys enjoyed this this podcast. And yeah, take it easy.
Yeah, and just like and subscribe our YouTube channel.
Yeah,
all our social media, like Julian said. Check out. Wait, this week there'll be a new episode of The Comic Drop, and hopefully seeing spots.
Hopefully.
But Comic Drop is definitely happening. I keep my word, unlike Julian.
Thank you.
I love Julian. Okay.
I'm trying.
I know you do, Julian. You do more for us than, I mean, without you, there would be no Comic Spot. So, thank you guys for listening. Have a great week.
Take
See
it
you
easy,
guys,
guys
next week.
Later. Listen up. Here's what the core can do for you.